This is Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket with Don Shane and Bo Schembechler.
How in the heck does Michigan State respond today after a devastating loss to Notre Dame? And can the Wolverines win back that little brown jug? That's just two of the topics Bo and I will discuss today. Welcome to the Big Ten Ticket. Number one topic, I think, with Michigan football right now is its devastating defense. In your view, against Wisconsin, they had six straight three and outs to start the second half. Can they be even better and more effective than they have been playing right now?
Oh, I think so. I don't think they're, you know, that's a young defense. They've got a long way to go.
Well, that's a scary proposition for some other teams coming in, isn't it?
I think it's, you know, for a long time, I've not seen us as strong up front. I mean, we can pretty much handle most offensive lines, and I think that's going to be true right up through the season.
Is it surprising to you to be able to see the defense do that with basically those four guys up front? Not like the linebackers and those other guys aren't good players, but they're causing havoc without bringing extra people.
That's the deal. If you can do that, then you have a defense. Right now, that's the way they're playing. Plus, they have some depth up there, too. They got some guys. They can substitute in there. If they get into a situation where they have pass rush, they can put another line in there, and they'll be really effective.
Another fabulous day for Mario Manningham. Is there a better – I know they talk about that kid down at Georgia Tech a lot, but is there a better receiver right now in the country than Mario Manningham?
Well, he runs those patterns like a snake. I mean, he goes, and he's gone. If they can get the ball to him, he's going to be open a lot. Mm-hmm. And he's got wonderful hands. I think he's a rising star. He scored six touchdowns already. Mm-hmm. We've only played four games, so he's got a ways to go.
And now, though, it's going to be, you would think it would start to get a little more difficult for him, teams paying extra special attention to him.
Well, I don't know whether I would do that. There's some other guys on there that could catch the ball, too. Uh-huh. Stevie Breston's still on the team, you know.
Yeah.
And they've got some other guys in there that are pretty good receivers.
He's also a quiet kid, kind of reserved. He was almost embarrassed at the press conference afterward. He didn't even want to do it last week. That's unusual. These wide receivers are kind of usually, you know, cocky guys, and boastful. Yeah. I guess that's a good thing, huh, for him to be that?
I think it's good, yeah. Sometimes these guys get to thinking they're a lot better than they are, you know. And that makes for some problems. But he's a wonderful kid. He's got a lot of potential, and they're going to need him.
Series of revenge games for Michigan. You know, all of a sudden, now it's Minnesota's turn for Michigan to try to win a game that they lost last year. Is that a factor, these revenge things, one week after the other or not?
You know, the little brown jug didn't mean very much until they carried it off right in front of them in their own stadium. Now, if they go up there to Minnesota and play in that building they got, and they carry that jug off again, I'm going to tell you something, that's gonna hurt. Mm-hmm. So if you ask me, does the jug mean anything? In this game, it does.
It does. That revenge issue takes place a little bit. Well, we talked to the players and Lloyd Carr about this revenge issue, and here's what they had to say.
I just want to come get the trophy, you know, but that was last year. We're not living in the past. We just want to go out this year, work hard, and try to come away with a win.
We really can't dwell on the past. It's a new team. They have a new team. So last year was a bad feeling, but we got to look forward to this game.
I want to win the Big Ten championship and the national championship. And every team that goes on the field against us is, you know, my motivation, because they're trying to stop me from getting what I want and what we want as a team. So the brown jug is a nice trophy and all, but what we want as a team for the year is motivation enough for us.
It's a new team. It's a new season. You know what happened. Everybody else is going to remind you of what happened. But your focus is what's important. It's not what other people are talking about or thinking about. It's what you're thinking about, what you're concentrating on.
That's a bad scene when those players come over there to your side of the field to get that jug. I know you're going to disagree with me. I know the Paul Bunyan thing comes up as maybe the ugliest. I think the jug is kind of ugly, you know, I know.
No, the jug has great tradition, Don. That's a special, absolute special.
Look
thing.
At that. Look at that thing. Why is that so special?
Well, look at it. It's back in the days of Fielding Yost, they carried the water in that jug. Because the water wasn't any good where places they went to play. and so they put it in the jug. And look at him holding that jug up.
If that doesn't inspire this Michigan team, nothing will, right? The jug's got to be the inspiration.
The
huh?
jug is.
Yeah.
The jug. I lost that jug once in Michigan Stadium, and I never forgot that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Bo and I will talk more about the Minnesota game a little bit later on in the program, but coming up next, a ridiculous comeback by the Irish last Saturday. We'll analyze that and talk about how MSU gets past that disappointment. Wide receiver Mario Manningham continues his terrific play, gets another honor after catching two more TD passes against the Badgers. And Drew Stanton, stood up and took responsibility for his play and his mistakes last week against Notre Dame. We'll deal with that as well. And the Big Ten Ticket continues, so please stay with us.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket is brought to you in part by the University of Michigan Health System. Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket is brought to you in part by the University of Michigan Health System.
Welcome back to the Big Ten Ticket Show. MSU had the Notre Dame game won. Big halftime lead, 16-point fourth quarter. They let it slip away. Let's begin first with the way Michigan State was playing first 3.5 quarters in this game. I mean, they look like world beaters.
Well, offensively, I don't think that Notre Dame had an answer for them. And consequently, they were moving that ball and running, passing, anything they wanted. When they ran that big Cochran in there early in the game, I thought if they gave him the ball 20 times, he would punish Notre Dame with about 175 yards. Mm-hmm. And so they pretty much did what they wanted for three
All
quarters.
Right. I know you watched it. I watched it. As you were watching it unfold and seeing what they were doing, going, did you believe that at any point they were going to lose that football game, or do you think they had it won?
At no point did I think until it got down right toward the end, and then I said, my God, they're gonna blow this game. And sure enough, they did.
All right, fourth quarter, there was a collapse, and there are lots of things to discuss here, but there was a fumble by Stanton, a couple interceptions by Stanton. Let's first talk about him, I guess, and the mistakes that he made that he took some blame for. This kid's a pretty good football player, and he made some uncharacteristic errors here.
Yeah, he did. I don't know whether they could have controlled him a little bit more, saying, look, you cannot make a bad throw here, and you cannot be scrambling outside the pocket, carrying that ball around. You can't do things like that. You've got to stay in there. We've got to play a little more controlled than Michigan State is accustomed to playing because they're on top. Michigan State, if they have a weakness, is that they can't play with a lead because they're
not going into a shell, though. They're still trying to do what they do best.
That's right. But once you get down there to just a few minutes, you got to start thinking we're ahead in the game, and I'm thinking clock now, and I've got to do that. I can't be wide open.
Right. What are the psychological implications here? I know we're no doctors here, but you've coached teams who have tried to come back from something like
this. They've got the greatest psychological way to handle this.
Playing a lousy team.
Illinois.
Playing a garbage team.
Because no matter what they do down there, there's no way they're going to lose that game.
Right.
And so that'll make them well.
All right, the MSU players looked stunned on the field when this game ended. They felt like they gave it away, and really they did. It'll be a very tough game for those guys to forget about.
It's frustrating, there's no doubt about it, especially with going up against a rival like that. You'd like to come out on top, but it wasn't necessarily the loss. It was the way that we lost that was frustrating. But it's part of the game, and we have a new life because the Big Ten season starts today.
That's one thing about being in Drew's position. Everybody's going to point the finger. Okay, why did we do this? Why did we do that? Why didn't we pick up the blitz and give him a second to throw the ball? Okay, so it's not all Drew. And you have to put your arm around him and say, we're going to learn from this, and we're going to get better, and there's going to be other opportunities.
I told the guys in the locker room, we're, you know, getting ready to leave. We can easily go 11-1. Now, we got to look at that game and see that, you know, a lot of people ain't give us a shot to win that game. And, you know, we put ourselves in position to win it. And if we can play the way we play Saturday, every Saturday, man, everything else take care of itself. You know, we'll be top three in the Big Ten, if not winning the Big Ten, you know, going to a great bowl game, having a great season, and all this will be history.
You know, there was something else that happened in that game that really got John L. upset. A sideline incident after a late hit on Drew Stanton. Matt Trannan got an unsportsmanlike penalty on the play. Allegations from Charlie Weiss that he was slapped in the face during all that. Here is John L. on that issue.
I got upset because I thought the official didn't handle the call right. I'm going to stick up for our guys, okay? And I thought our guys were, they didn't throw a punch in the whole deal. You listen to some cock and bull story, and you change it, and now you make it a no call? After a kid gets hit like that out of bounds, is wrong. So that's why I was upset.
All right, he's upset. He's upset at Weiss for saying he was slapped and not saying it was a player and then changing his story about the whole thing. He even brought a tape to his press conference for everybody to look at. Just because you don't see it on that tape doesn't mean it didn't happen. Who knows if all the cameras were there. But your thoughts on that whole mess and what's going on and, I guess, some nastiness between the two schools.
Well, there's no question it was a penalty. Got hit out of bounds.
Right.
Start with that. There was the ordinary pushing and shoving in there. I didn't see anyone hit the coach. I mean, I think that's probably not true. Mm-hmm. That would be my guess.
Why is Weiss saying that then?
Because he probably, you know, if you're in that pile in there, you might have got grazed. Somebody might have grazed by you, but I don't think that anybody slapped him. Mm-hmm. No, but I could be wrong, but I don't think so.
Do you think, it also shows when Trannan went in there, he got hit from behind and got yanked and whatever, and he ends up with the penalty on the
play. Well, he went back in, I think, went back after him. He was not going to accept that. Mm-hmm. And so he went back in and pushed and shoved a little bit himself.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just one of those things that those officials should have jumped in there and handled, mm-hmm. and hauled him back out of there and penalized Notre Dame 15 yards for hitting Stanton out of bounds. Mm-hmm. That's all that should have happened there. And then called him aside and said, hey, you guys cut this stuff out or somebody's going to be thrown out of this ball game. Because that was really the first incident
right.
in the game.
Right.
It wasn't like it was a chippy game all game, because it wasn't. So that's what I thought should have happened.
I thought Clifford Ryan made a good point. I mean, he said we can go 11-1, but it's the non-conference loss to Notre Dame. They got the Big Ten season to look forward to. They feel like they can go on and win the Big Ten championship.
Well, that's the only really good thing about playing Notre Dame is that if you don't win the game, they're not a conference opponent. So they have no bearing on the Big Ten championship. And so he's absolutely right. They can go on and win the rest of their games and have a great season and forget about that Notre Dame game.
You know, John L. had to do some really good coaching with his team last year after they had that lead down in Ohio State and kind of blew that game. And mm-hmm. I would think he has to do a really good coaching job, even though they're playing Illinois, as you mentioned, this week with those guys.
Yeah, but I think, and I don't want to overemphasize that, but I think playing Illinois helps.
Bo and I still have a whole lot more to talk about, including the problems that some teams have playing in the Metrodome. We'll deal with the Gophers running game without Lawrence Maroney. The Big Ten Ticket is back after this. Every week, Bo and I select a player of the game sponsored by Michigan Healthcare System. And this week, it is Mario Manningham. He just might be a legit candidate every week, huh? Two more touchdown catches against Wisconsin. That's five in a couple of weeks. The rest of the way, he is a marked man for other teams. We talk about that. Mario knows it, and so does Lloyd Carr.
Everybody who watches those film, the thing they're going to say is, hey, don't give up big plays. I mean, that's fundamental to this game. There's nobody that's not going to try to take it away, and there are certain ways you can take it away. Then you got to find other ways to move the football. You know, we're not designed to statistically get the ball to Mario. We're designed to get the ball to the open man.
That's an interesting point, because we touched on this earlier in the show about now teams maybe paying more attention to him and what happens, and you said Breston and the other guys are going to be. You think Lloyd is almost relishing that situation? I mean, go ahead.
Sure.
Do that. That's
sure.
not a problem for us at all.
Sure. I think that's absolutely true. You just have to have your quarterback. If they're going to come over and double on him, there's got to be somebody singled up somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't think that should bother them at all.
Okay, how about, though, the obvious communication and chemistry that has developed with Henny and Manningham, if you go away from that, that changed. I mean, there's obviously a comfort level with Henny going to Manningham right now. They got something going there.
Yeah.
And you don't want to mess with that.
Well, you're not going to abandon it.
Right.
You know,
but you're not going to force that either.
No,
right?
You're going to look. If it's there, take it. If it's not, I'm going somewhere else. I think that's the way they're going to look at it. But no, they'll not abandon it. If they don't throw passes to Mario Manningham against Minnesota, they're crazy.
I think they probably will.
Yeah.
All right, you mentioned Minnesota. Navarre and the team made a miraculous comeback up there, but that's not a terrific college environment for teams to play. And it's not necessarily fun going in there and play, is it?
No, it's no fun at all. You play downtown, and even the students, you know, they got to drive to the game. And it's an away game. It's an away game for Minnesota every week.
Mm-hmm.
And the sooner they get that stadium built on campus.
Which they're working on.
So that those students can come out of the fraternity houses and the dormitories and go down to the game. That's the way it's supposed to be played on college campuses.
Mm-hmm.
And so we'll all look forward to that. But up until that time. We got to play in that stupid dome.
Yeah, it is kind of a stupid dome. But you played there before.
Yes.
And when they had some big crowds,
yes.
And you got a great story about what
I told the referee I'm going to sit on the ball.
Why?
Because if he can't stop the noise, I'm not going to jeopardize.
But isn't that the home team's prerogative to be as loud as they can and try to disrupt what you're doing?
I never felt that way. As a matter of fact, back in those days, I always felt that it was courtesy for the home crowd.
To be quiet for you?
Sure. not to interfere with the... And, you know, these guys that wave the towels and these players that go, you know...
Well, that's college football. What's wrong with that?
Oh, that's great, except
all right.
for one thing.
What?
It hampers your communication. And if you're a sophisticated team that wants to get into the right play by automatic in the line of scrimmage, it really hurts you.
All right. Do you think those fans care that you can't do what you want to do in that situation?
It's all right. I'll just sit on the ball. They let me do it. They let me do it for 10
so
minutes.
So you're telling me the crowd, they got the crowd to quiet down so you could run your plays?
A little bit. They didn't get it quieted down.
Did you win the game?
Oh, sure.
Oh, that's all that counts.
But that's all that counts. But, you know, as a matter of fact, I think you'll find out that we're running 11-0 in the dome.
Yeah, that's good.
So
we're okay.
We got a reasonable chance to win.
Reasonable, yeah. The Michigan game is obviously important. The state game is important. But there is a huge game in Iowa City. The Hawkeyes taking on number one Ohio State. It is the game of the conference this week. Bo and I will talk about that one when we come back. So hang with us.
Ruben and Jake Long have been bugging me since they got here, to get a pass to them, to let them carry the ball. So I designed that play to get Reuben a pass. I don't like what he did with the ball. I mean, he lost 5 yards. He didn't run with it. And so that plays out of our playbook. So if these guys come around complaining about not getting the ball thrown to them, just tell them that, you know, if you get a chance, you got to do something with it.
Yeah, he just fell down.
And not a good thing if he's begging the coach that he wants it. Yeah. What do you think of that? Little refrigerator Perry's, I guess. Is that an issue, or would you let him do what he wants?
Keep in mind, when you bring him back here to in the backfield to run with the ball, somebody got to go up there and block.
Yeah. Got other guys who can block?
Yeah, well, there's somebody else that can run the ball block at fullback, too.
Yeah, right. So you never did that, right? Brought a lineman in the backfield?
No. I always had a fullback. I didn't have any.
Ohio State at Iowa. That is a large football game with national championship implications, Big Ten championship implications. Can Iowa win that football game at home?
Sure. Iowa can win the game at home if they can expose Ohio State as not being as great a football team as everybody thinks they are.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way they can win that game. But as you and I sit here, we know that Iowa is not an awesome power. And so, therefore, the combination of the two, that Iowa playing at home with a lot of enthusiasm and a pretty good football team, exposes Ohio State as not quite as great a football team as everybody thinks they are.
Mm-hmm.
And if that's the case, then Iowa can win.
The Buckeyes certainly struggled against Penn State at home last week, even though they won the football game. As you look at them, what is their weakness?
Well, they have not rushed the football very well, and that's kind of surprising. I think they're going to be more effective when Smith starts to run a little bit more.
Okay.
And, you know, usually you don't like your quarterback to run.
You want him to run.
I think he's got to run a little bit more.
All right, we'll see if he runs a little bit more at Iowa. That is it for this week's show. Next week, as big as it gets, almost, Michigan State at Michigan, and Bo and I will have a lot of fun talking about that one. But today, it's MSU and Illinois coming up next right here on Channel 7, and Michigan at Minnesota tonight on ESPN. Enjoy the games, everybody. Thanks for watching. Bo and I hope to see you again next week.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket is brought to you in part by the University of Michigan Health System.
The national spotlight. Tonight, they'll fight for a symbol of what was lost a year ago. The oldest trophy in college football belongs to Minnesota. The Wolverines, like their reputation, want it restored. Jug was a Michigan coach's water jug left behind after a game in 1903. Rather than return it, Minnesota said you have to win it to get it back. That challenge started the oldest trophy game in all of college football. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick, Todd Blackledge. Great to have you with us. Holly Rowe will join us shortly. Last year, Michigan had its worst season in 20 years. 7-5, dropped out of the polls. This year, undefeated, number 6. What happened?
You know, a lot of the names and faces are the same, but this is not the same Michigan team that played last year. This Michigan team has a different attitude, a different focus, a different sense of purpose, and nowhere does that show up more than when you watch this Wolverine team play defense. Under first-year coordinator Ron English, they are flying to the football. They are first in the country in run defense, fifth in total defense. They are fast. They are physical. They pressure the passer. They stuff the run, and they're a mature group. 7 of the 11 starters on this defense are seniors. They were guys who were around last year for that embarrassing 7-5 season. Much different team this year.
Well, Michigan has played Minnesota very tough. 3 straight games. Minnesota won one last year by 3 points, lost the other 2 by 3 points. They liked how it felt. They want to keep it going.
Yeah, they should have a lot of confidence because they have played Michigan well. They've got to do 3 things tonight to win. Number one, they've got to be strong against the run. Soul that Michigan offense. They must win the field position battle. They've got to cover kicks and cover Stevie Breston, and they must throw the ball well early in the ball game to take some pressure off a very vaunted running game. 5th-year senior quarterback Brian Cupido has to play exceptionally well tonight for the Gophers.
The Gophers on the field. Kickoff is next from the Dome in Minneapolis. ESPN's College Football Primetime is broadcast in high definition and presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. It's already been a really busy day at the Metrodome. Baseball first, 11 a.m. Central, the White Sox and the Twins. The White Sox win at 6-3. The game ended around 1:30 Central time. 46,000 fans left this building, and then the crew had to do exactly the same thing. Holly Rose down on the sidelines. Holly, it's quite an operation.
Well, it is, and you'll actually notice some unique things to the field tonight. I'm standing on home plate. It's the skinned area. There is a slight lip, and in the field of play are first and second bases. Guys, I talked to the Minnesota receiver, Logan Payne, before the game and asked him, how will this affect the team? He said, hey, we played on this field just like this for spring football, so he doesn't think it's a problem. I didn't see Michigan, however, warm up on this side of the field. They spent the entire warm-ups on the other end, so none of their players have tested out how this dirt and grass lip will affect them during the course of play. We'll keep our eye on it.
All right, Holly, and almost inevitably, if there's a seam somewhere, somebody's going to hit it. There is Joe Mauer, the Twins catcher. They are one half game behind Detroit. Detroit playing tonight in a rain delay, and there's the condition of the field Holly was talking about, Tom.
You know, and quite honestly, it really doesn't come into play in your normal play situations. Where it does come into play is in kicking situations, field goal kicking situations if you're on that area, and also if a quarterback is dropping back to pass off the turf into the dirt, it might be a little slicker than the actual turf surface. But for the most part, I don't think it's a big issue.
The series between these two schools, as you might imagine, has been dominated by Michigan. You see, they won 33 of the last 36. But Minnesota won it a year ago, and it's the 95th meeting since they started playing each other in 1892. And Michigan is the oldest football program outside of the Northeast in all of college football.
Well, right away, we see one of the important keys for Minnesota in this game, their ability to cover kicks. Stevie Breston, the senior, is one of the premier return guys in the country. Most people have not been kicking it to him on kickoff situations. A little harder to avoid him in the punt return situation. Let's see how Minnesota approaches it on the opening kickoff.
Joel Monroe, who is very good on kickoffs, has several touchbacks this year. Will they go for the deep one, go for a squib, pooch? Are they going to play it against Preston?
I think if they can, they'll try to drill this thing up into the student section.
Monroe, a 5'11", 190-pound sophomore. Got all of it and drove Preston 4 yards deep. They'll keep it there.
Well, Michigan offensively, when they are moving, it's Chad Henne playing with a lot of confidence. His third year as a starter. Mike Hart, he's the heart and soul of this Michigan offense. They want to run the football first. He leads the Big Ten. And Mario Manningham has become the go-to guy. Every third time he touches the ball, he scores with it. And most of those have been of the long-distance variety.
Chad Henne starting his 29th straight ball game for Michigan. He is 20-8 as a starter, averaging a school record 212 yards passing a game. And they've had some good ones. Hart is the tailback.
Time will be kept on the field.
We've already lost the scoreboard.
Well, you know, the clock is supposed to start when foot hits the ball instead of when it's caught by the returner, and no time ran off, so obviously there is a problem.
Well, obviously, they don't use it for baseball. So nobody checked it out,
I guess.
There
is no clock in baseball.
No, there isn't. So the clock will be kept on the field, and we'll update you as often as we can. Hart, 8 yards behind the line of scrimmage is the single setback, and he'll get the carry. Off the left side, and Hart will drive for nearly 10 yards before he is taken out of bounds by Jamal Harris. One reason Michigan offense has improved this year is the experience they have up front, including the tight end. Five of these six guys are seniors, and they know how to get it done.
And Jake Long, I'll tell you what, he's about as good an offensive lineman as you'll see anywhere in college football. He was a right tackle last year, playing left tackle this year, and he is a dominant run-blocking guy over there on the left side. Big number 77.
He was elected as a captain and said it was one of the greatest honors he could ever imagine to be the offensive captain of the Michigan football team. Two tight ends are in on this formation. Two wideouts and a single setback. Again, it's Hart. And again, Hart will get the ball in a gaping hole. Nice cut. Hart picks up 10 on his first carry, 12 on his second. Both first down runs, and here goes that big-time running game.
Well, Michigan has changed their approach. New coordinator Mike DeBoard is a zone-running offensive team. The first play was an outside zone. This was inside, and that gives the back the ability to cut back. The two tight ends, you seal the backside, and you give that back the ability to either go front side or backside.
And the big wide receiver Mario Manningham got him a good block. Again, Hart straight up the middle, this time contained for only about 5 yards. If that's going to be his worst carry of the night, they're in good shape.
Yeah.
Minnesota needs great play up front and from its linebacker. Sherrills and Shevlin are the two top tacklers on this team, but they can't be making tackles 10 yards past the line of scrimmage.
They are an undersized defense compared to this Michigan offensive line. Therefore, it's very critical for them to play with great technique and play with great leverage against this Michigan running game.
Kevin Grady will come in at tailback. Much heralded sophomore. And he'll get a carry. Dances to the outside. Stood up and pushed back. Gained maybe a yard.
The good news for the Minnesota defense, I mean, they still have to execute and they still have to make tackles and be physical. But they're used to going against zone blocking because that is what Minnesota offensively has done so well under Glenn Mason. They are a zone blocking offensive team. So all through summer, all through spring, they're used to seeing a lot of zone blocking techniques. But seeing it and defeating it are two different things.
Yes, they are. Third and three. Hart. Nice seal on the left side, and Hart will get the first down. That was the tight end Mike Massey who just walled off that left side, and Hart could go anywhere he wanted out there.
Yeah, that was a great block by Massey. Lloyd Carr made some changes in his staff. He said he looked at everything in his program at the end of the year, which a good head coach would do. 7-5, not up to Michigan standards. He knows that above anybody else. Looked at everything in the program, brought in two new offensive coordinators, had two guys go to the NFL. Thought his team was heavy at the end of the year. Got everybody to buy into losing weight, being more athletic. So far, they are off to a tremendous start.
Five straight runs to start the ball game. 39 yards. This is number six. Hart has the outside again.
83 is just destroying the right side of the Minnesota defense. Mike Massey, 6'4", 234-pound tight end, a junior out of Brecksville, Ohio. Watch him just seal this outside. I mean, that's an easy run for Mike Hart because the tight end is getting great position and not allowing the Minnesota defense to get outside and maintain outside position.
Willie Vandestig, number 91, is just making it too easy for him. He's got to keep contain over there. Now Grady is back in at tailback. Bobbled on the snap. Henny with time, throws sideline, and was it in?
Boy.
It was complete. Breston, a gain of 17. Breston has been the short guy this year, only averaging 10 yards a catch.
He's had some trouble hanging on to the ball, but the coaches said he had a great week of practice this week catching the football. You see Henny look to his right where Manningham was, and nobody around Breston over on the left sideline. Watch that defense flow to the Manningham side, and Breston left all alone on the left sideline.
Boy, and a play fake kept the linebackers within about 3 yards of the line of scrimmage. They had no chance to get back and help. Hart comes back in. This is textbook so far. Nice cutback by Hart. And then good close by Deion Hightower to make the tackle and save a bigger gain.
We talked about for Minnesota, number one, they have to be able to be strong against the run. They've got to do whatever they have to do to defend the run. Now, that might mean they've got to go to some single coverage outside and bring an extra defender in there to play against the run. That's not ideal against a guy like Mario Manningham, but they cannot allow Michigan to just run the football up and down the field tonight.
No, this will get ugly early if they don't take a chunk out of this. Hard again. Penetration in the backfield coming up from the corner. Tremaine Banks, the four-year starter at the outside corner, or the boundary corner, rather. And he just came up and drilled him. Yeah, and nice. That's what you were just talking about. You got to do something different.
There's number four, Tremaine Banks, on a corner blitz. And it kind of surprised Adrian Arrington, the receiver out there. I'm not sure he knew what to do when that corner crossed his face. A good call by defensive coordinator David Lockwood to change up that defensive scheme.
And whatever he did, it wasn't the right thing. It's third and 10, passing down, you would think, for Henny, who was changing the play. Manningham is to the far side. They throw back the other way. Touchdown, Arrington. He easily beat Dominic Jones, and Henny was right on the money.
Yep. He's got a great arm. I mean, I was watching him before the game, just even in warm-ups. I mean, that ball really comes out of his hands quickly. Great velocity. And he's using his eyes. I mean, that's when you see a quarterback getting more mature. In this drive, a couple times already, he has used his eyes. That time looked left and threw right. Before, he looked right and threw left.
Garrett Rivas for the point after. And Michigan takes the opening drive and is literally almost not slowed down on the way to the other end zone. They score on the opening possession. They're up 7-0. Michigan draws first blood, 7-0 here in Minneapolis. You get the feeling if the field was 300 yards long and they scored anyway?
Yeah, that looked way too easy for the Michigan offense. They struggled a little bit last week against Wisconsin at times. Boy, they didn't struggle on that possession.
Dominic Jones, DJ, is deep. He's number two in the country in kickoff returns. Take it on the second bounce off his own teammate's hands. Cut, lost his footing a little bit and went down at the 23-yard line. Todd, what happened on that touchdown pass?
Well, it's, again, a quarterback maturity, okay? Over here is Manningham. So you're going to see, as Chad Henne goes back, his eyes are looking this way. Now watch what happens to the safety just from that little look over. Right there, the safety is reading his eyes and not able to get back and make the play. That was DJ Jones, the heart and soul of that Minnesota defense, but the eyes of Chad Henne fooled him.
First play is a pass complete for a first down up to the 37-yard line, and it's Ernie Wheelwright with the catch from Cupido.
Wheelwright getting up slowly, wants to come out of the ball game, and they need him in the ball game.
That's his seventh catch. Cupido tied for second all time in career touchdown passes at Minnesota with 40. Number three all time in yards. The coaching staff says that he has to play great for them to have a chance to win. And Penix is just swallowed up by that defense.
Well, Minnesota, when they have the football, they're impact players. Ryan Cupido, fifth-year senior. Good decision makers, got to throw the ball well. Amir Penix made his first start last week, 174 yards. Started the year as the third-team tailback. And Logan Payne, kind of a blue-collar wide receiver. The last three games, he's had six catches in each game. So he has really emerged on the outside from Minnesota.
Three wide receivers to the near side for Penix. The single setback. Cupido with time throws to Penix, and Penix is drilled by middle linebacker David Harris. The Gophers' offensive line, very good with its zone blocking scheme. They have keyed the offense with 2,000 yards rushing and passing the last 7 years. They're the only school in the NCAA to accomplish that feat. And that's a stat that really stands out for people who are not familiar with Minnesota football.
And the key position in this offensive line is the center. They've had two great centers. And now Brinkhouse is the new center. He was a tackle last year.
Four-man rush against Cupido. Has time, dumps it off, and same play, same result. David Harris on the little check down to Penix, and Harris is right there to make the tackle. No first down.
It's good discipline by David Harris. He's playing very, very well. A senior, one of those guys who lost 11 pounds, feels like he's quicker, has better energy, better stamina, has really kicked up his preparation this year. And two plays in a row, he stayed at home and read the little check down to the back and made a solid tackle in the open field.
Said most of the time those midnight fast food runs are over. Most of the time.
Yeah.
Cusack to punt. And Preston is the deep man. Signals fair catch and makes it to its own 16-yard line. 41-yard kick. No return. That's good news for Minnesota. But the bad news is they're down 7-0 after one possession.
Reese Davis with you. Primetime Pulse. Show you what's going on in the family of networks. Ohio State and Iowa. You see Antonio Pittman making a nice run there. Look what's happening on ESPN2. Houston on top of Miami late in the third, 13-7, guys.
Well, thanks, Reese. Didn't know you were going to be there. Hart is the tailback as they start from their own 16. Less running room this time, gets four up to the 20. It was Van de Stieg and Hightower on the tackle.
You know, it's interesting about Mike Hart. He's not as big as some of the backs they've had at Michigan. He's listed as 5'9", but he's 196, almost 200 pounds. And his lower body, I mean, he's got big, strong, thick legs. He has excellent balance. He's tough, and he's elusive. He makes people miss, even though he's not a real flashy type runner.
Hard off right tackle. Big hole. Dives forward. Should have enough for the first down.
The last time Michigan had the football, I mean, they went right at this Minnesota defense and said, hey, we love our zone blocking and we love Mike Hart. Try to tackle him. Good blocking at the point of attack. To run the zone effectively, you must control the line of scrimmage, and Michigan was able to do that. And then when they needed a pass on 3rd and 10, Henny found Arrington. And for Adrian Arrington, that's his first career touchdown reception.
Hart's had a pretty good first quarter, 55 yards so far. They get 65. Breaking tackles, knocked out of bounds. We got the clock back, and it stopped at 7:01 first quarter.
Mentioned that he is the heart and soul of this offense. He's an emotional leader. He missed four games last year, and Michigan really was not the same without him. I mean, he is a very smart player. I mean, he's good in the passing game. He's good in pass protection. And we've already seen tonight he's excellent with the football in his hands.
Grady will come in to give him a breather as they will measure for a first down. And it is a first down. Ohio State, Iowa, you're interested in that ball game, and Ohio State driving early in that contest on ABC. Oliolebo, number 40, is in as a blocking back, and he's got Grady offset behind him, and Grady will get the carry. Picks up a couple before he's shoved back by the middle of that line. Let's check in with Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, Taco Bell studio update. Top three teams in the land on the road this weekend, including USC in Pullman to take on Washington State. John David Booty to Steve Smith. This would get the Trojans inside the five and set up a touchdown. 14-6 late in the first half.
All right, thanks, Reese. We have 6:23 and counting here. The Dome in Minneapolis, and Brandon Miner, number 4, the third tailback, that Michigan has used is into the ballgame his first time. Second and 7. Wolverines from their own 40. Henny, good play fake, no pressure at all, right down the middle, intended for Manningham, and Manningham had a stride and a half Massey, but Henny missed him.
One of the things that makes Mario Manningham so difficult is he is an excellent double move guy. Watch, plants to the inside, back out, and then in, and he's, that cornerback has no chance if the ball's thrown to Manningham. A little bit over his head, great route by Mario. Just a slight overthrow by Chad Henning.
So when he came back to fall camp this year, there was the wow factor. Yeah. He was just bigger, faster, and he has just run by people for those touchdowns he has this year. Proud trying to encourage the Minnesota defense on third and long. Henny, finally some pressure, and they got him for bye.
Well, good pressure, but good coverage downfield by the Minnesota secondary.
Van de Steek from one end, Davis from the other.
Last third down, he threw a touchdown this time. Nowhere to go with the football. Excellent coverage downfield. It was only a 4-man rush, and they got to Henny late.
So Michigan will kick it. Zoltan Mesko to kick to Dominic Davis.
Wow.
Booms one down to the 8. Davis. Nice cut. Boy, nearly had something going there. Took it back over the 20 to the 21. Van Alstyne made the tackle on special teams. 13-yard return after a punt of 54. Can Minnesota get its offense going?
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Aflac. Ask about it at work.
The McNamara Alumni Center stands on the site of the old Memorial Stadium, and the center serves as a major entryway to the university. The arch is from the Memorial Stadium Arch, the only remaining structure from the on-campus stadium. And 3 years from now, they will have an on-campus stadium at Minnesota. It's going to be a tremendous boost to the Golden Gophers football program. Congratulations to Glenn Mason and the staff. And the university administrators who are going to make this happen. Penix, nice run, and Penix driven out of bounds. Let's go to Reese Davis.
Mike, number one team in the country, Ohio State in Iowa, frenzied atmosphere. Troy Smith, Anthony Gonzalez, touchdown. It's on ABC. Buckeyes up by 7.
Penix shows some spark in the Minnesota offense. Yeah.
Great balance also, because it looked like he might have gone down for about a 6-yard gain, kept his balance and turned it into a big gainer.
Spath was the tight end in motion. Penix shakes one tackle, but then buried by the second man.
Let's go back to the last big running play. Matt Spath, a dominant run blocker. Here he is. Watch him come in and crack back on the defensive end, Jamison. And that sets up the play. Then you're going to see the center, Brinkhouse, pull out. Good blocks at the point of attack, and then the balance by Penix. But a good first play for the Minnesota offense. The second play, however, not so good.
Cupido pressured out of the pocket. Throws on the run too high, intended for Wheelwright.
Well, you see the power of Allen Branch, number 80 in there. And he is a big, physical guy who is playing very well for the Michigan defense. He's the guy who forced Cupido out of the pocket on the play action. They had everybody blocked except for number 80, Branch. He's going to force Cupido out, and then that's a tough throw. Rolling to his right, trying to throw back to his left slightly. Branch is 6'5", 330 pounds. And a tremendous athlete.
How does a guy that big move like that? That's amazing.
He's a running back in high school. How about that?
No thanks. Cupido, good protection this time. Throws and dropped. Right in the hands of Logan Payne. He had to turn a little bit, but certainly a catchable ball.
Well, there was some contact back there with Jamar Adams, the strong safety.
Jamar Adams, number 22, is going to get tangled up with Payne. Pretty good protection for Cupido. And when Payne came off that contact, he just wasn't able to pick up the football quick enough. Well, they could have called that pass interference, I think. That was contact.
I think you're right.
While the ball was in the air.
Cusack, the punt to Breston, holds all the career punt return records for this school and makes another fair catch to 23.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Mercedes-Benz, located on the web at NBUSA.com, and Holiday Inn Express. Stay smart. Stay at a Holiday Inn Express.
Seven nothing, but an encouraging exchange of punts from Minnesota. They played better on defense and better on offense than they did on the first series. Hart is back in there, and Henney goes out to Breston on a little flanker screen, and Breston is drilled by Dominic Jones. Check in with Reese.
Mike, SportsCenter 30-30, and I know in your neck of the woods are primarily concerned with the AL Central, but Dodgers and Padres, you see the Padres celebrating there. They've clinched playoff spots. Padres' magic number is one to go into the playoffs as the NL West champs. And Vince Young's going to make his first career start for the Titans against the Cowboys on Sunday. SportsCenter after the game, ESPN News all the time.
Thanks, Reese. From the 30, Henny quickly to Manningham.
Well, you see the strength again of Chad Henney's arm. That's a long throw, even though it's a three-step drop and a five-yard route. When you're throwing from the left hash to the right sideline, that ends up being about a 35-yard throw, and Chad Henney throws it right on a rope. A lot of quarterbacks in college football can't make this throw. Three-step drop from the left hash, no air under that ball to the right sideline or the right numbers, and Manningham able to catch it and turn upfield. You got to give him cushion because of his speed and his ability to get by you. So that short pass, very difficult to defend.
I was just going to say, that's a nightmare for a DB because he's probably 10 yards off to start with. Hart only gets a couple. There's some uniforms when you're channel surfing and you turn on a game, you wonder, well, I don't know who's playing. You know, if it's Michigan, you can't miss those uniforms. Can't miss the helmets.
That is a good-looking helmet.
That's the great tradition of Michigan football, and the uniforms are a big part of it. That's the end of the first quarter in Minneapolis, where Minnesota is trailing the undefeated Michigan Wolverines at 7-0. Welcome back to the Dome in Minnesota. Michigan scored on its opening possession to take a 7-0 lead. That's been it so far, but Michigan has certainly dominated the statistical page. 125 total yards to only 38. Hart was 67 yards rushing already.
Well, they dominated the clock, too. I mean, they had the ball for almost 12 minutes of the first quarter, only 3 minutes of possession time for Minnesota. Hard to gain yards when you don't have the ball.
Second and long, Henny, nice play fake. Throws on the run, had Breston wide open and threw it at his feet. Have a red zone alert on Ohio State and Iowa, number one against number 13. Iowa driving.
I think Iowa's going to really challenge Ohio State tonight because of Drew Tate, an experienced quarterback, the first experienced quarterback that the Ohio State defense has faced this season.
No, I've already seen that game. It was a great one. People watching on ABC ought to keep watching. Third and long, Henny. Four-man rush. Plenty of time. Throws underneath. and very close to a first down. The tight end Mike Massey made the catch. All depends on the spot. He dove for the 45-yard line, and the sticks are right inside that mark. And where they're marking it, it doesn't look like he has it. The yellow line, of course, not official, but it's very, very close.
It's a good open field tackle by Deion Hightower, a young linebacker, probably their best in-space linebacker.
They like him, don't they?
Yeah, they really do. Sophomore out of Arlington, Texas.
Kid's only 210, but he can run. Olebo is in. Several tight ends are in. Hart got outside, first down and more. Hart driven out of bounds to the 38-yard line.
You mentioned Olebo being in. He got the key block because Minnesota tried to bring the corner blitz again. Trumaine Banks was coming off the corner, and Olebo alertly saw it and made the play. Watch Olebo with his eyes open pick up the corner, buries him, and that allows Hart to get to the outside for the easy first down. Olebo was a linebacker when he came to Michigan, was very shocked and disappointed that Coach Carr wanted to move him to fullback, but he has really adapted to his new role.
Apparently he's taking it out on other people. Penny straight down the middle, and it's a touchdown to Arrington. On the post, a beautiful throw, and he beat Trumaine Banks. That was pretty.
Well, it starts with protection, and then what Chad Henne sees is no safety help. Nobody deep, one-on-one post route. And Arrington got his man turned and got inside of him, and a good big target for Chad Henne.
37-yard touchdown strike. The point after will make it 14-0. And Henne in the first half, two touchdowns, 99 yards passing. He's hit six of his first eight.
Reese Davis with you, keeping our finger on the primetime pulse. On the family of networks, Iowa and Ohio State, Buckeyes just stiffened on defense, held the Hawkeyes to a field goal. It's 7-3 late in the first. And Miami's taking the lead on Houston, as you see Kyle Wright dancing out of bounds there. Miami on ESPN2, though, still in a fight in the fourth quarter, 14-13.
Boy. Michigan on top here, 14-0. Another long drive, this one 77 yards. Dominic Jones got a couple of good blocks and took it up to around 25 yards.
Let's go back to the touchdown. Now, watch Chad Henne. He is going to move the safety, DJ Jones, again with his eyes. He's going to be looking this way. Watch him look him off and move him out of the pattern. Now, once he's got that open, he's got all this area as Arrington's going to run into that open area. All he has to do now is make sure he doesn't overthrow. He moves the safety with his eyes, and then he throws a perfect pass to Arrington. Arrington, no career touchdown passes coming into tonight. Two in the first half.
Penix. Nice hole up the middle, running hard to the 32-33-yard line where Prescott Burgess made the tackle. Well, the Minnesota coaches told us earlier this week that they knew they had to stop the run. Right. And if that meant the defensive backs ended up on an island a lot, they just had to make plays because there's no other way to go up against Michigan.
Yeah, I mean, it's choosing your poison right now because Chad Henne is throwing with great confidence, and he is on target. So you've got to try to stop one thing, and so far they haven't stopped either one.
Penix again picking his way this time for about three out to the 38-yard line. Jamar Adams, the strong safety, who's been very good in run support, comes up and makes a tackle.
Amir Penix started the season as the third-team tailback. E.J. Jones was actually the starter in the opener against Kent State. Then Alex Daniels became the starter. And Penix got his first start last week. Been in the program a long time, over 1,000 yards in his career.
Spaeth, the tight end, gets up to about the 42-yard line. The All-American candidate, as Jamar Adams makes another tackle. Let's go to Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, number two, USC on the road in the Palouse against Washington State. Alex Brink to Jason Hill. That's his 29th career touchdown pass. Somebody call the fashion police on the Cougars' jerseys, but they are down by just two at the halftime.
Oh. Boy, Reese, wow. You're right.
Must be a Pac-10 thing. Oregon, Washington State. Oh.
Too many look like softball uniforms.
Boy, David Jones, or David Harris, really is
something, isn't he?
He is. I mean, and he's just, he's reading quickly. He's running downhill. The key to this Minnesota offense is controlling the line of scrimmage, but watch how quickly Harris reads it and comes underneath the offensive line to make the play behind the line of scrimmage. No false steps, no false movement. It's Ron English, the new defensive coordinator. He's got an intense personality, and it's really rubbed off on this defense this year.
And all the coaches love Harris's practice habits. So he goes really hard all the time. Penix. Great run. Got away from Harris. He got down to the 45-yard line. So Penix has given them the offensive lift. A couple of times he's broken runs. That was for 15. And keep in mind, Michigan is number one in the nation against the run. 18.5 a game. That's all.
Well, this was an adjustment where they brought the guard or the tackle in the center and pulled out, and it was a great block by Logan Payne, the wide receiver who came back on the crackback block. That's what sealed the corner for Penix to get outside.
It's funny when you watch Penix run, he doesn't look as fast as the guys that are chasing him, but he runs away from him. Now Daniels comes in. And they give it on the end around to Logan Payne, the wide receiver. And Payne picks up some good yardage. Let's go to Holly Rowe on the sideline. Holly?
Well, guys, you've seen Amir Penix be very effective so far in the first half running the ball. Last week when he got his first start against Purdue for the season, he ran for 173 yards. Now, the coaches say it's because he's a blue-collar kid who will absolutely give you everything he's got when he's out there. But he says it's because he's had to be patient. He had to wait his turn to play here, and he said what's made him good is when he got his opportunity, he took it.
Sure did.
He wants to keep it too, Holly, even though they're going to rotate some guys. Daniels fumbled the toss and then taken down at the 38. And the running backs for this club come in small, medium, and large. Jones, Penix, and Daniels. Daniels is large, 255.
As a former linebacker, just kind of took his eyes off the ball. You got to catch the ball first. Bobbled a little bit. That slowed down the play and allowed Burgess to get there.
Of course, they had the great tandem of Lawrence Maroney and Brian Russell. They lost Maroney to the NFL, first-round draft choice of the Patriots, and Russell to academics. So the door was wide open for running backs. Penix lowers his shoulder, got nothing.
And Branch right there again, along with David Harris. Branch is just a load in there. I mean, he's a hard guy to move.
Running to him is pretty much over, isn't it?
Penix tried to cut back, and nowhere to run with Mr. Branch inside there.
He's outweighed by 130 pounds. So face-to-face, he's not going to do a whole lot.
Boy, no hesitation at all by Glenn Mason.
I like this.
Mitch Browning, offensive coordinator, 4th and 3.
Not going to get that many shots. You might as well take them. Are they trying to draw them off?
I think they might throw right now to Payne.
Penix. Got it! Nice fighting job. For extra yardage down to the 26. You got to love the call. Yeah. And you got to love the execution of the run.
And really, that was Brian Cupido.
Yeah,
because
it was.
That was his responsibility to check to the right running play at the line of scrimmage. They check to the outside zone. The fullback leads, gets a great block on Prescott Burgess, and that enabled Penix to cut up in for the first down. Glenn Mason, 4th and 3, told us yesterday, he says, you know, it's a whole lot more fun to coach to win than to coach not to lose.
Boy,
that's coaching
right.
To win right
you're
there.
Right. And Daniels will get maybe a yard, pushing and shoving after the play. Got a red zone alert for you for Miami and Houston, with Miami up one and driving.
Well, that is a game that the Miami Hurricanes and Larry Coker desperately need to win. Already two losses on the season. Minnesota having some success running the football right now. Nobody has had any success running against Michigan. Minnesota, by far, the most success.
Kupero with time, throws back. Penix. That's the third time they've gone to him out of the backfield. Hall made the catch, or made the tackle.
Well, this Michigan defense is fast, and so far, you see the discipline. They're staying in their lanes in the running game. That time, Leon Hall was not fooled by the misdirection. You know, normally, when you throw it back to a back like that, you're expecting that whole defense to be flowing with the quarterback. They stayed right in position to make the stop for very little gain.
Third and four. Three wideouts. Penix is the single setback. Kupero wants it all. Got a man in the end zone. That should be a touchdown. No! Logan Payne caught the ball, but they said he was out of bounds. Stewart had the coverage.
Well,
and they're showing it on the Jumbotron. That's why the crowd went nuts.
Nice throw by Kupero on the fade over the outside shoulder. Does he have possession and get 1 foot in?
That's a touchdown.
That is. That's a catch. Now, they're bringing the field goal team out. But I'd take my time if I'm Minnesota and allow them to review this.
He had the ball at an odd angle his arm.
But in one arm.
That doesn't matter. If he's got possession, he's got possession. The angle doesn't matter. One arm doesn't matter.
And the ball didn't even bobble when he hit the ground.
Nope.
I mean, he had it in one arm, 1 foot in, hit the ground, and the ball never even moved.
Folks, that's a touchdown.
That's
and
a phenomenal catch,
yes,
too, by Logan Payne. Great throw by Kupero over the outside shoulder, and a great catch.
Now, here's one of the ironies of college football. Minnesota and Michigan are playing a game. Usually Michigan is going to get the call simply because they're Michigan. It's not, I'm not saying the officials are doing anything wrong. That's just the way it happens. The big cheese gets the call.
What a play. I mean, you cannot throw that any better. When you throw a fade route, you must throw it over the outside shoulder away from the defender. It's exactly where the ball was, into the left arm of Logan Payne. His right foot is down. That is a whale of a catch.
Boy, wasn't it? Beautiful throw.
Following the review, we have indisputable video evidence. Solid possession by the receiver. Catch inbound.
What a great job by the officials. Hats off to them. That's the beauty of instant replay.
And the beauty of the college instant replay. That didn't require a coach challenging
That's
the
right.
call.
And it's a 21-yard touchdown pass play. Kupero now number two all time in Minnesota quarterbacking history with 41 touchdown passes. 12 plays, 75 yards. You don't get too many 12-play drives against that Michigan defense.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Aflac. Ask about it at work.
And Minnesota has given the Golden Gopher fans something to cheer about. They score on a nice drive against Michigan and are down only 14-7.
Logan Payne is going to run the fade route right to the corner, and as soon as Kupero sees this safety squat on the short route, he knows he's got one-on-one coverage against Carl Stewart. Beautiful throw to the outside, right over the outside shoulder, and Logan Payne with his sixth touchdown catch of the season.
Steve Breston and Darnell Hood are deep. Breston only needs 18 yards to break Anthony Carter's record for total yards on kickoff returns. And he'll have his chance from the two. Stacked up and
great
didn't
coverage.
Get to the 20.
Great coverage. High kickoff, great coverage.
Monday night, Brett Favre and the Packers try to even their record to 2-2 as they face Donovan McNabb and the Philadelphia Eagles. Is it Monday yet? Monday Night Football on ESPN at 8:30 Eastern, also available in high definition on ESPN HD and in Spanish on ESPN Deportes. I don't know that there's been anybody in the last 15 years, 20 years, any more fun to watch than Brett Favre.
Yeah. Yeah, he plays with a reckless abandon.
Yes, he does.
You really got to respect him for that.
And he's still got the laser. Yep. He can chuck that thing. Hart is back in, a tailback for Michigan. And turn back as he got up to the 21-yard line. Let's check in with Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, this Minnesota team told us the most important thing about playing tonight was to believe that they could win against Michigan. After that last touchdown catch, Logan Payne went and was fired up, yelling at his teammates. He said, they're not that good, guys. They're trying to make themselves believe that they can play with Michigan. And after that drive, guys, maybe they can.
I think they can, Holly. I mean, they've run for 64 yards against Michigan. Remember, the first four opponents of Michigan combined coming into tonight, only 74 yards rushing. So they're running the football. Brian Cupidoe is on target throwing the football right now. And the last 3 years, even though Minnesota's only won one of the matchups, they have played exceptionally well against Michigan.
Second and five for the Wolverines. Hart. At about three, it'll bring up a third and two. You mentioned the last 3 years have been close, all 3 points. They won last year in Ann Arbor. Michigan had its biggest comeback in school history to win in 2003. Then they won their 16th in a row, and then Minnesota broke that streak and got the little brown jug a year ago.
The 2003 game, Michigan scored 31 points in the fourth quarter to win.
Third and a short two, flanker screen. That'll be enough for a first down as they got it to Breslin. They like that two-man screen. Let's go to Reese Davis. Reese?
Mike, the primetime pulse again. The game's going on in the family of networks on ABC. Ohio State and Iowa just started the second quarter. Buckeyes still with a 7-3 lead. Buckeyes forcing a punt now. On ESPN2, Miami clinging to that one-point lead on Houston inside. 6 minutes to go.
Well, that brings back memories of when Miami played Houston when they were both in the top 10. When David Klingler was there, and we thought it'd be such a great game, and Miami just beat him to a pulp. Penny, plenty of time, got it to Breston. Hightower showing you that speed coming up to finish off the tackle. But Breston on another good throw from Henny.
Well, again, the play action off the running game, single coverage, and Jamal Harris was in position, but he's going to slip. Watch number 15 slip when he comes out of his break. He slips and falls down. That gives Breston a cushion to make the catch, and then he held onto the ball when Hightower hit him from behind. But we're going to see a lot of man coverage now from Minnesota because they realize they must commit extra bodies to stop this Michigan running game.
Olebo, the fullback, in front of Hart. Trying to get off that left side again.
Good job. Good job of defense, stringing it out. We've seen Willie VanderSteeg have some problems, get hooked a couple times. That time he didn't get hooked, and he maintained outside position and forced that ball back inside.
Join us late. We're at the Metrodome in Minneapolis, where number 6 and undefeated Michigan is taking on the Golden Gophers of Minnesota. Michigan scored first. In fact, they've had two long drives in this ballgame, but Minnesota has cut into the lead and trying to slow down that powerful Michigan running attack right now. Henny, another good play fake. Massey, the tight end, across midfield down to the 47-yard line. Let's go to Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, starting tight end Tyler Ecker for Michigan is out of this game, and it looks like for the rest of the game. He has what is looking like a high ankle sprain that he suffered on the very first play of the game. So in his place, Mike Massey, who just had that catch, and their third string tight end Carson Butler suspended for this game. So fourth stringer Brian Thompson is in there, and he seems to be doing a fair job.
All right, thanks for the update, Holly.
And Mike Massey looked like he was a little shaken up at the end of that play where he just made the catch.
Third down at about 4.5 yards. Thompson is in as the tight end, as Holly just told you. He is number four on the depth chart. Henny straight back to throw. Plenty of time. Got it to Arrington. Where they're going to mark it, it's going to be enough for a first down as the middle linebacker Mike Sherrills took him down.
Henny just showing great poise. I mean, he changed the play at the line of scrimmage. Looked very Peyton Manning-esque there. You know, making the audible against a hostile crowd and the noise here in the dome. And then right before the play clock ran out, snapped it and made the nice throw for the first down conversion.
Clock running under 4 minutes to go. Henny very, very efficient in the opening half. He's already thrown for 125 yards. Good play fake this time. The blitz, they pick it up perfectly. Manningham wide open. He had Jamal Harris beat by two steps, and Henny threw it perfectly. 41-yard touchdown.
Well, Minnesota tried to drop a safety down late, and Chad Henne saw that, knew there was no help in the middle again. And these post routes, Minnesota has had no answer in the open field for the post routes by the Michigan wideouts.
Revis for the point after. And Michigan with that quick strike capability. And Henny on target for another bomb to the explosive Super Mario Manningham. Michigan has had great receivers over the years. Anthony Carter, the three-time All-American, Desmond Howard, David Terrell, Braylon Edwards. And is this the next guy? Mario Manningham. Is he in line to join that group in the record books? He certainly has the speed. Certainly has the big play capability. You made a great point in our meeting the other day. He has rarely been challenged. You don't know how good a guy is if he's wide open all the time, do you?
Well, he makes it look easy, I'll tell you. And he doesn't drop it.
Dominic Jones. But this kid's tough. He just fights for everything.
See, the problem for Minnesota right now is David Lockwood, the defensive coordinator, they're having to make a choice. Do we commit that extra body to stop the run? If we do that and we don't get pressure on the quarterback, if they go to throw, we got a problem. And these touchdown passes have been against single coverage with no help in the middle, and post routes with no help in the middle are very difficult to defend. Or do we keep a safety back to stop that from happening and then try to defend the run with one less guy? Very difficult the way Michigan's playing right now.
Penix, who's had a good first half, is back in there. Kupato to Payne, shakes a tackle. Payne up near the 45. 14-yard gain for Logan Payne. Let's go to Reese Davis.
Mike Pontiac Performance Halftime Report not far away. Let me correct something I said in the Primetime Pulse a minute ago. Ohio State got the ball in an interception, not a punt. They turned it into a touchdown against Iowa. We'll get you up to date on that. Talk about Michigan State's collapse and also the hunt for October in baseball. It's all coming up at halftime. Mark and Lou will be here too.
All right, thank you, Reese. Minnesota trying to move the ball with under 3 minutes to go in the first half. They're down two touchdowns. Pressure coming. Kupato airs it out. There was some contact on that pattern, and Payne is really complaining that he was interfered with by Leon Hall, and I think he's got a pretty good argument.
Well, the only problem for Brian Kupato on this throw is he didn't put very much air under it. Rather than throw it up a little higher and let Payne run under it, he threw that thing on a line. I don't know. I think the contact was incidental. It was just got a normal contact down there with Hall. But the ball would have been difficult for Payne to catch because it was thrown with such a flat trajectory anyway.
You're right. Leon Hall looked like he got one of those chicken wings out there and maybe interfered a little bit with Payne, but I guess not enough to make a call for that official, who certainly had a better angle on it than we did. Penix, nice hole. Nice cut by Penix down to the Michigan 41-yard line. And that 18.5 yards per game against the rush is disappearing tonight. 71 so far for Penix.
And a nice block by Spaeth. Excellent job by Penix cutting inside the block by the tight end Spaeth, number 89.
Penix running hard.
And sure the best thing for the Minnesota defense right now is if they don't have to come back on the field. I mean, the less they spend on the field, the better off Minnesota will be. That means the offense needs to stay out there.
Fullback in there this time is Justin Valentine.
Penetration.
Boy, and they just exploded through the middle of the offensive line. Lamar Woodley, the All-American candidate, one of two captains on this team, was in there on the stop.
Lamar Woodley just going to anticipate and come right inside the block of the tackle. Tavali, the guard, rather. He came on an inside stunt. Tavali not ready to cut him off. And Woodley, one of those senior guys, a lot of starting experience, has been a dominant player here this season.
Kupito on 2nd and 14. Some pressure coming. Gets it off. Complete down to the 35-yard line. Again, nice catch by Logan Payne. And Charles Stewart makes the tackle.
Well, for Minnesota, they almost have to get another score in here. And a touchdown more so than a field goal, because Michigan's not having to settle for field goals. They're scoring touchdowns. So Minnesota's going to need to score touchdowns as well.
Penix shakes one tackle, dives inside the 35 to the 34. Rondell Biggs gummed everything up and made the tackle, and Glenn Mason, who has already gone forward once on fourth down and made it, that set up their touchdown play, has a timeout with 56 seconds to go and a chance to make up his mind on whether he goes for it again. Here's tonight's Aflac trivia question. Which two former Michigan coaches have more career victories at Michigan than Lloyd Carr? Think about it. We'll give you the answer later. One of them ought to be really easy for you. The other one you'll have to dig. Fourth down, penalty flag kills the play.
Well, now it's going to be 4th and 8. Much different situation.
64, offense, 5-yard penalty, still 4th down.
Wouldn't you go anyway?
Yeah, I think so. You know, there's 56 seconds left. Too far to kick a field goal, I would think.
You know what? That was the first penalty. That's remarkable.
You know what? They're going to punt the ball. And I guess I understand because of this. They have not been able to slow Michigan down. And the worst thing that could happen is to give them a short field and let them stick one more touchdown in before halftime, the way Chad Henne's throwing it.
Cusack will punt. Breston goes back. But he's not going to get much of an opportunity, I don't think. And it's kicked out of bounds to the 7-yard line. So if Michigan wants to do anything offensively, they're going to have to do it with only 49 seconds to go on the clock. Here's the answer to our trivia question tonight, the Aflac question: which two former Michigan coaches have more career victories at Michigan than Lloyd Carr? Bo Schembechler, 194 wins, and Fielding H. Yost with 165. Lloyd Carr has 106. Fielding Yost was the guy who left the little brown jug in Minnesota in 1903.
And that's the guy that wants to take it back.
Yes, he does. He's got a leg up on it right now at 21-7.
Great record, 106 from 34, 75% winning percentage.
And considering the teams he plays every year, that's a remarkable percentage.
You know, I don't think we're going to see Michigan use any of them, but I'm impressed by this. They have all three of their timeouts left to end the first half. Mm-hmm. We've done a bunch of games already this year, and I don't know that I've seen any team be that efficient with their clock management, getting in and out of the huddle, calling their plays. They don't need any of their three timeouts. They go to the locker room with a 14-point lead.
Very well disciplined, very well coached. They've shown it in the first half, and they've jumped out to a 21-7 lead at the half. Now let's join Reese Davis for the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
Lloyd Carr said he loved that jug. 30 minutes away from recapturing the little brown jug. Glad to have you with us on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report. Reese Davis along with Lou Holtz and Mark May. This one of the games in the Big Ten. The other one going on ABC. The Buckeyes, number one in the land in Pennix Stadium to take on Iowa. Troy Smith, Anthony Gonzalez.
What a quick move by Anthony Gonzalez on the post, Pat, and first score of the game for the Buckeyes.
7-3 game, second quarter, first play from scrimmage in the quarter, and Drew Tate picked off by Brandon Mitchell in the ensuing drive that would set up Antonio Pittman.
Just a nice run here. He'd made a great run to get it down to the 5-yard line, takes it in.
But the Buckeyes couldn't keep that big lead for long. Iowa on a drive. Albert Young knifing between defenders. The first rushing touchdown Ohio State's allowed all year. 14-10. It's a barn burner. Top three teams on the road. USC at Wazoo. John David Booty, Chris McCoy. First career touchdown. Then Booty would find Steve Smith. This long connection would set up a touchdown made it.
A nice job of the offensive line of protecting the quarterback, John David Booty, but he can go to old reliable Steve Smith with Dwayne Jarrett out with a shoulder injury.
Saturday afternoon on the Palouse. Third and goal, tougher than you ever imagined. Alex Brink, Jason Hill, 29 career touchdown passes. That's just three behind Dwayne Jarrett. College football halftime show coming your way in just a moment. We'll give you plenty of highlights from today. Huge upset in the ACC. Some redemption for Urban and the Gators against the Crimson Tide. And we'll also show you the hunt for October and Tigers run for six in a row.
The Pontiac Performance Halftime Report is powered by Pontiac. Vote for this week's Pontiac game-changing performance. Go to ESPN.com, keyword Pontiac. Welcome back to the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
Chad Henne has made a living throwing to Mario Manningham, but he doesn't always have to throw it to him. Adrian Arrington's hauled in a couple of touchdown catches. Michigan on top of Minnesota, 21-7. In the ACC, Georgia Tech and Virginia Tech. Frank Beamer had the Jackets in his house. Georgia Tech jumped up 7-0, and oh, a Cardinal sin. They left Calvin Johnson.
You know, Bud Foster, the defensive coordinator of Virginia Tech, is not happy about leaving the best receiver in college football, 6'5", 235, and runs a 4-3 and closes the deal right here. Puts Georgia Tech up by two.
Georgia Tech went up by three touchdowns. They were ahead 21-0. Brandon Orr picking his way. Virginia Tech tried to get back in this thing. You know, Georgia Tech had 21 points after 12 plays in this game, but the Hokies were gaining some momentum when the defense comes up large. Phillip Wheeler hits Sean Glennon. Gary Guyton scoop and score. 38-27, the Ramblin' Wren. Houston and Miami. This game just finished a little while ago on ESPN2. Kevin Cobb going in for the Cougars. Here is Pontiac game-changing nominee, Kyle Wright, James Bryant out of the backfield. That gave the Hurricanes the lead. And Larry Coker, I'll tell you, under serious heat. There's Coker, will to get out of there with a victory, 14-13 over Art Briles and the Cougars. Alabama and Florida, Steve Spurrier hitting his number and name up on the Ring of Honor. 1966 Heisman Trophy winner. Here's Chris Lee finding Dallas Baker.
The touchdown maker.
Pontiac game-changing nominee. The game changer, the Florida defense. Reggie Nelson coach picking off John Parker Wilson.
This ball's overthrown. Just a nice catch. And once you throw outside and it's picked off, usually going to be a touchdown because you have no angle or pursuit to tackle.
And that one put it away late in the fourth quarter. 28-13, Florida beats Alabama, Purdue, and Notre Dame. Purdue, one of those unbeaten yet untested teams. And Charlie Weiss, well, game-changing nominee Trick Oration from Samarja.
Anytime you try to block a kick, you first of all have to say, can we stop the fake? Give them 3 points, not seven. Nicely designed by Notre Dame.
And here is Curtis Painter. Painter finding Selwyn Lyman. Lyman had a better day than any receiver ever against the Fighting Irish. He went over 200 yards receiving. Charlie Weiss and the Fighting Irish, able to put this thing away when Brady Quinn finds Raymond McKnight. Painter threw for nearly 400, 35-21, the final there. And now this is what Notre Dame has lying ahead before they go to USC.
They should win each and every one of these games by a minimum of 2 touchdowns or more. It's a fabulous opportunity for Brady Quinn to pad his stats for the Heisman. He should have 300 or more passing yards in each one of these games.
Illinois and Michigan State. Now, what better guy to be the Grand Marshal of Sparty's homecoming parade than the man who says, or the frog who says, it ain't easy being green? Because it was not easy for the men in green. Michigan State and Illinois. Drew Stanton here appeared to fumble the football. Play was reviewed. Later ruled an incomplete pass, but Stanton left the game when he was hit. He was injured on the play and did not return. Although Sparty got a break there, down 20-10 in the fourth quarter. Brian Hoyer, backup quarterback on his first play. No time to break him in slowly. Hits Kellen Davis for the gain to the one. Michigan State will punch it in on the next play to make it 20-17. Now, Brett Swenson to tie the game. When you considered Illinois has lost 10 straight Big Ten games coming into this one, you can sort of feel the noose tightening a little bit. But now they don't worry about the noose. They've got juice. Juice Williams to Kyle Hudson, and now Jason Rita to break the streak, coach.
And it just creeps inside the left upper.
And Illinois beats Michigan State on homecoming 23-20. A bitter, bitter loss. Skirmish afterwards, bitter loss for John L. Smith.
Rather than point fingers at everybody, we're going to point the fingers at ourselves. As players, as coaches, we're going to come to the field and we're going to work hard. See if we can't get better. We have a long way to go. So now's a real test, emotionally, mentally. And about all I have to say.
Test, frankly, that Michigan State has flunked the last few years. When they've blown big leads, had devastating emotional losses, they haven't recovered. How much of that falls at the feet of John L. Smith, Luke?
Well, I think a lot of it does, certainly. I know when I was at the University of Notre Dame, we blew a big lead against Tennessee when we were number one in the country. You just got to be able to come back from it. And that starts with you. You as a football coach, you better be positive about where you're going and how you're going to get there. I would ask this question. Why did we lose? Is it personnel? Is it players? Is it a position? And if somebody didn't show up, would we miss them and why?
Michigan State trying to rebound. Didn't do well against Illinois on this Saturday. We'll have the pennant races for you. The hunt for October. A couple of teams have made their way into the postseason. We'll tell you which ones and who still has work to do.
The Pontiac Performance Halftime Report is powered by Pontiac. Vote for this week's Pontiac game-changing performance. Go to ESPN.com, keyword Pontiac.
Vince Young, the former Texas star, will make his first start for the Tennessee Titans Sunday against the Cowboys. Tennessee winless. And get the kid from Texas in there, see if he can give them a spark. Setting the table for the NFL weekend, Chris Burke.
All right, thank you. We're all over the biggest stories of week four. T.O. and the accidental overdose. How are the Cowboys and their star wideout dealing with the specter of this week's media frenzy?
The rumor of me taking 35 pills, I think it's absurd.
Baltimore and San Diego do battle. Which team has the better defense? Tom Jackson takes sides. Why does Tom Brady look frustrated? Ron Jaworski breaks down how Tom Terrific deals with having less weapons. Is Steve Smith healthy? Does he feel underpaid? Michael Irvin sits down with the Panthers' dynamic wideout. Join us at 11 a.m. Eastern for Sunday NFL Countdown on ESPN. Now to Mike Tirico and the Monday Night Football crew.
Well, in Philadelphia, we'll have the Packers coming off their first win, which was in Detroit last Sunday, and the Eagles, other than their fourth quarter collapse against the Giants, they could be looking at a perfect season so far.
Big star power Monday night, a quarterback with Brett Favre and Donovan McNabb. All through the offseason, people asked about Favre. Does he have anything left? All through the offseason, they asked about McNabb. How will he survive the T.O. fiasco? Doing pretty well so far, aren't they?
Oh, I'd say they are. When you take into consideration, Donovan McNabb is averaging 320 yards a game throwing the football. And Brett Favre, the guy who really struggled and wasn't sure whether he was coming back, 340 yards per game the last two games and three touchdowns. I'd say they're doing pretty well, Tom.
The Eagles know there are big headlines and a lot of media waiting next week when Terrell Owens and the Cowboys come in. A pretty significant game against the Packers on Monday night.
Not Monday yet. see how much baseball we have on Monday, or can we settle all the pennant races over the weekend? Brewers and Cardinals. Cardinals down 2-0 in the eighth, in trouble trying to hang on to their lead in the NL Central. Scott Spezio is going to knock in three. Pujols, Rowland, Encarnacion score. Cards take a 3-2 lead. In the ninth, Adam Wainwright on to close it out. He gets a man named Brady Clark, rounding into the fielder's choice. Cardinals win 3-2. Their magic number to clinch the Central is now down to one. Astros and Braves tied at two in the top of the ninth. Astros have to win this game. Let's go to the Dodgers and the Giants. Top three tied at one. Julio Lugo with men on first and third. The double's going to score Rafael for call and give LA the lead at 2-1. Top five, Dodgers lead 3-2. J.D. Drew, men on first. Jeff Kent motors home around from first. Dodgers win 4-2. Dodgers are on their way to the playoffs, either as the champion of the National League West or as the wild card winner. Either way, they too are going into the postseason. Padres and Diamondbacks, 3-1 final. Padres also going into the postseason as far as the division champ in the NL West. San Diego's magic number is 1. Oh, unhappy day. Phillies have been eliminated. Pedro Martinez has been eliminated from the postseason and from the start of the regular season next year. The calf muscle got him for the postseason. Now it's been discovered he has a torn rotator cuff in his pitching arm. He won't pitch off the mound until next June. All right. This is Ohio State and Iowa. Troy Smith to Roy Hall, the fifth-year senior, making the touchdown catch. That Ohio State offense has been a juggernaut. 21-10, the game is on ABC. Tiger Woods is going for his sixth straight victory on the PGA Tour. Looks as if he's going to get it. I'll tell you why.
To the Metrodome in Minneapolis, where the undefeated and sixth-ranked Michigan Wolverines have only a 21-7 lead, but they have racked up 166 yards passing, only 73 from Minnesota, 101-75 rush yards. And remember, Michigan came into this game number one in the country, averaging only 18.5 yards allowed per game. Minnesota's done a lot better than that. And actually, Minnesota's had some pretty good moments in the first half.
They have. You know, we talked about things that they needed to do to have a chance to win. They've done some of those. They've covered Stevie Breslin on the kicks. Brian Cupido has thrown the ball well. The only problem is this Michigan offense has been almost impossible to stop because Mike Hart's running and Chad Henne was 10 of 12 throwing the football.
Pretty good combination. And the kickoff is going to go out of bounds around the 10, and that is a major error for special teams. This is our game track, and it's been a long time battle for the Little Brown Jug, the series that started for that trophy in 1903. Arrington, a big game, three catches, 59 yards, and two touchdowns.
You know, I know the Michigan guys, when we talk to their coaches, they kind of downplayed the whole revenge thing and, you know, getting the jug back. But the bottom line is, this is the third game in a row Michigan's playing a team that beat them last year, and they looked very focused tonight.
I mean, you played for a big-time program. If somebody at Penn State, you didn't lose that many games. If somebody beat you, the natural reaction is the next year you played them, you wanted to get them
back. Absolutely. You want to get them back. And also, you think about what Lloyd Carr and all the coaches and all these players heard all during the offseason, you know, about the program. Had it slip, 7-5, what's wrong with this team? You know, will you be any better next year? And this is a team that has played with a completely different attitude and sense of purpose this season.
Second and four. Penix, who had that good first tap, picking his way again. And Penix is showing tonight he is an outstanding running back against any kind of competition. Let's go to Holly Rowe. Holly?
Hey guys, I checked with both coaches at the half. Lloyd Carr said he was pleased with the first half from a standpoint of good situational play calling against the right defenses, no turnovers, and good hard effort. He said they need to improve their run defense. For Glenn Mason, I said, how do you pick your poison? You bring the safety in the box, and then you give up the long pass play. He said, we can't do it. We've got to bring the safety back. We can't leave those wide receivers one-on-one. We need safety help.
And absolutely. Holly, that's exactly what Todd was saying at the half when we were talking, that they can't allow this to go on any longer. Michigan just doesn't miss a deep pass.
Well, if Chad Henne was struggling, then you could take the chance. Now, this is a critical potential injury.
It's your best line
for Minnesota. Brinkhouse. Tony Brinkhouse is their starting center. This means Tyson Swaggart, who was the backup center last year and is the starting left guard, will move over to center.
And they'll bring in Ruckdashel, number 74, to play the guard spot. Brinkhouse, they moved from tackle to center. And they pull their center a lot when they run wide plays. And he is simply their best offensive lineman. It's going to hurt to have him out of there. And David Harris makes the tackle on this play.
Well, Swaggart is a good center in his own right. We talked about the two centers they've had prior to this. Ben Hamilton and Greg Esslinger, both guys are in the NFL. They're both with the Denver Broncos. They were outstanding players. Esslinger won the Outland Trophy and the Remington Award last year. So you're replacing some great centers, but Swaggart has played the position before.
Two tight ends in this formation. Coupeau to throw, and double coverage, and missed his wide receiver, Eric Decker. Monday and Hall were back for the Wolverines, and they'll have to kick it away.
Ryan
Coupeau, excuse me, it's third down.
Has played pretty well tonight. He's thrown the ball effectively. He's got rid of it. They haven't gotten any sacks. Michigan came in with 17 sacks. They haven't gotten to him tonight. He's made some nice checks at the line of scrimmage in the running game. He's got to make a big throw here on third and 10.
That was Brinkhouse they were working on the sideline. Had his right leg elevated. Here comes pressure. They pick up the blitz. And enough for the first down. Well, you got to like Logan Payne. That guy just knows how to play.
Well, Logan Payne and Amir Penix, because Penix is going to pick up a blitz that allows Coupeau to make the throw to Payne. Watch Penix come over here and pick up the blitzing linebacker. Great job picking up Burgess. That allowed Coupeau to find his crossing receiver and make the big throw.
And a lot of times in college football, you've got guys who can run, but they can't block for the quarterback, and therefore they can't play. You got to protect that guy with a ball. Fake the end around.
He's got Wheelwright.
Coupeau down the middle. Wheelwright wide open. Touchdown. Nice play and beautifully executed. Now there's a flag down. Back near the line of scrimmage in the backfield. Holy cow, it's coming back.
Well, the body language of Nedvard Tavali, number 66, the right guard, is suggesting that that penalty was on him. Everybody else was down celebrating in the end zone, and Tavali was standing
holding
there with his head down.
74 offense,
yep, not
10
him.
Yards, previous spot, still first down.
That's Ruckdashel, the young man who came off the bench. Boy, they fooled him. They set this up perfectly.
It was Ruckdashel. Here's the guy. Now remember, Swaggart moved to center. He's trying to cut off the big guy, Branch, I believe. No, it was actually Terrence Taylor he was blocking on number 67. Boy, they did have it set up. They faked the reverse, wide open. Can't let those opportunities slip away.
Didn't see much on that one, Todd, to make a holding call.
Especially considering you could call holding every play.
Just about. And boy, what a perfectly executed play. Would have gotten within a touchdown. And now Penix is belted by Engelmann as he came across the 50-yard line. Let's go to Holly.
Hey, guys. Tony Brinkhouse, the center, has had his right leg examined. He's complaining of pain on the inside high ankle portion. The good news is, though, they're taping him back up. They're going to let him put some weight on it and try to come back. Guys, they need that steadying presence on that offensive line.
The bad news is it might limit his mobility and being used as a puller, what they like to do in a lot of their outside runs. But you're right, his presence in there will be much needed.
Decker comes in as an additional wide receiver. They'll give it to Penix. Maybe a yard or two. There are a couple of plays every game that just change everything. Well, certainly that holding call was one of them. If you're Minnesota, it just breaks your heart. And you work on a couple of plays during the week. You say, you know, in a certain situation, this could work. This could get us a huge score and turn the game around. Glenn Mason calls it, gets it. It's executed perfectly, comes back on the hold. Third and a mile. Pressure coming on Cupido. Throws on the run. Out of bounds. Michigan has the luxury when it's playing pass defense of just sending the front four. They can get pressure with those four guys, and they drop seven. You can double cover a lot of people if you drop seven.
Well, Branch very powerful on the inside. Lamar Woodley leads the team with five sacks. You're right. You can be very creative with your coverage if you can get consistent pressure by only rushing four.
Cusack to punt. Preston is deep. They've done a nice job on special teams, not letting Preston hurt them. This is returnable, however. And Preston went to a knee as he made the catch, and it's down there. 35-yard kick. Michigan will have it and go back on offense when we return to the Dome.
The Primetime Pulse of games on the family of networks. They're halftime at Kinnick Stadium in Iowa City. Number one, Ohio State with a 21-10 lead. On ESPN2 in the SEC, Georgia and Ole Miss starting the second quarter scoreless. Both Matthew Stafford and Joe Cox have played. Ole Miss had a blocked punt wiped out on a defensive holding call.
Last week, I don't know that I've ever seen a kid happier than Joe Cox after a ball game, and he earned it, too. The numbers on Henny, pretty good. 10 out of 12, three scores, 166 yards. And he didn't miss the ones where he had the chance to get touchdowns, either.
Movement, right side of the Michigan line.
Ball start, 83 offense, five-yard penalty. Still first down.
You mentioned Minnesota doing their part on special teams. Michigan's average starting field position, their own 16, backed up even further to start this possession. But what they were not able to do a very good job of in that first half was defend the pass. They couldn't get pressure on Henny, and they couldn't play man-to-man coverage on these Michigan wideouts.
One of the things they said they had to do was win the field position battle and stop Preston. They have certainly done that so far. It's kept them in the game. Draw play, Hart.
In the first half, Chad Henne was about as hot as a quarterback could be, and it was very easy for him throwing touchdowns. Used his eyes very well, and he just never looked out of rhythm, out of sync, and every pass was in stride to his receivers. Because Minnesota was trying to commit extra guys to the box, there was no safety help. And Chad Henne was too hot for that. That's why Minnesota's changing their philosophy. You're going to see two safeties back, and they're going to say, look, our front seven, you're going to have to defend the run by yourself.
And the wide receivers have done most of the damage. It'll be interesting to see how they do it, because that's what it looked like they were doing at the start of the ballgame. And Michigan went through them like crazy.
But the point is, it's a slow death maybe compared to the instant quick strike.
Yes.
But the benefit is, the more plays you make Michigan run, the better chance maybe they make a mistake.
Sure.
Maybe they drop the ball. Maybe they get a holding penalty. Something happens. You give them one play or two plays for big scores, too easy.
Looks like he has a first down up near the 25-yard line. For more on Chad Henne, here's Holly.
Well, guys, when we talked to Chad Henne this week, he said that 7-5 season from last year is defining who he is as a football player this year. He is specifically more motivated to be a leader and to take command of this offense. The players say that he is completely different, that he has got command. He lets you know when you've done something wrong. And Chad said he's noticed it. He said, when I step in that huddle, they know I mean business.
That's what you have to have, Holly, and certainly he has put up some great numbers for an undefeated team, and the offense and defensive balance has been great for this club.
You know, I think the other thing, and Holly touched on a great point, the other thing that's helped Chad Henne develop as a leader is because he knew the job was his. There was no competition. He's been in the system 2 years, 3 years. You know, it's hard for a freshman or a sophomore to assert his leadership. But when he's a junior and a three-year starter, he is the leader, and he's had time to really develop and work on that leadership aspect. I mean, he's the mentor now to a Mario Manninghaber or an Adrian Arrington. He's the older guy bringing those guys along.
Grady is the tailback getting a chance, and here comes the blitz. Got it out to Manningham, breaks one tackle up to the 43-yard line, where he's taken down by John Shevlin.
There's an indication where you see the added strength of Mario Manningham. A short hitch route, but the ability to break a tackle. You can't miss tackles in the open field, but the strength of Manningham, able to add about 7-8 more yards to that short catch.
You mentioned the leadership of a quarterback. Whether he wants to be a leader or not, a quarterback has to be, doesn't he?
He has to be, but you know what? If you've got juniors and senior offensive linemen in that huddle and you're a freshman or a sophomore, I mean, they'll follow you, but they do it a little bit begrudgingly.
That time, they stuffed Mike Hart as he got just back to the line of scrimmage. Here's Reese.
All right, Mike, USC in a fight to the finish against Washington State. It's 14-12 late in the third. John David Booty to Steve Smith. That made it 21-12, but it's 21-15 right now in the fourth.
Very interesting. You go on the road, you never know.
Yep. And, of course, the way USC has made their way, had their own way in that Pac-10. Everybody wants a shot at the Trojans. Washington State giving them a handful tonight.
Henne, another good play action fake, and that one bounces off of Manningham's hands. Chad Henne is not a name that leaps to mind when you talk about great Michigan quarterbacks, but look where he is in all these categories. Second in attempts and completions, third in yards, third in touchdowns, and they've had some good ones.
Yep. A lot of guys in the league. I think Michigan, former Michigan quarterbacks, more than any other school in the National Football League right now. Four or five guys. Of course, Tom Brady, the most visible of those guys.
Henne straight back. Only had pressure on him once. Manningham. And four dark red jerseys take him down after a gain of 27.
Boy, Minnesota just not able to generate any pass rush against this Michigan offensive line. They are really playing well tonight, blocking in the running game, keeping bodies away from their quarterback, Chad Henne. They know he has a hot hand, and they say all we got to do is protect him, and he'll get the ball to the right guys.
It is a very big offensive line, but it is also very athletic. Grady fumbles. That one's picked up by Breston, and Breston cut down at the 35, and it was Hightower who knocked it loose. He just blew up Grady.
Well, Steve Breston is used to fielding punts and kickoffs and balls that bounce off the turf, and he got another opportunity, albeit an unusual one. Ball pops right out, and Breston able to recover it.
Very fortunate for Michigan that they got it back. The ball bounced differently. Maybe Minnesota has a shot at going the length of the field for a touchdown.
Now look who's back in, number 20.
He does on second and 15. No, he doesn't. Hart hiding behind the lineman for a while. Now he tries to duck out of there and picks up a couple. Matter of fact, Hart coming into this game had gone 524 touches without losing a fumble. That's remarkable. He'd gone 450 without a fumble at all, which I think is a better streak than not losing one.
Right. That's right. Never even comes out of his hand. This is a big play right here for Minnesota. Maybe the biggest play of the game for them. Third down and long. They've got Michigan backed up. They're not really, it'll be a very long field goal attempt for Revis. They need to come up with a play right here on third and long.
They have 5 men on the line of scrimmage. Will they come with a blitz? They do. They come with 6. Almost got there, and the pass is incomplete to Massey. They hurried Henny enough so that he couldn't wait.
That's right. They got there enough not to get the sack, but to force the early and errant throw. One of the few blitzes we've seen. Sherrills comes in unblocked.
Every other. Come on to try to pooch it deep. High floating kick. Hits at the 1.
Oh, my goodness.
And downed maybe a half a foot away from the goal line. Stevie Brown, a backup safety from Columbus, Indiana, stationed himself at the goal line. The punt, 33¾ yards. What a play!
Coming up on SportsCenter, wall-to-wall college football. You know somebody in the top 25 is going down. Which National League teams locked up playoff berths and who's set to start Sunday in Tennessee? We'll see you after the ball game.
Oregon Cat.
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Allstate. Are you in good hands? And McDonald's.
And the punt, as we're back in Minnesota, beautiful city of Minneapolis. This punt that was down at the 1-inch line has now been ruled a touchback. And hats off again to the instant replay system. And my partner Todd Blackledge caught this one.
Well, Stevie Brown is out of the end zone, but the ball crosses the plane. See, the ball right there is over the end line. His feet are okay. See, now in college football, Stevie Brown could actually be standing with both feet in the end zone and down the ball in the field of play, and it could be down on the 1-yard line. But the ball cannot cross the plane, which it did. Still a great effort by Stevie Brown.
He did all he could.
Yeah.
So Minnesota gets a break, and they'll have the ball out at their 20. Brinkhaus has come back in at center. That's good news for them.
Sure is. That means Swaggart goes back to left guard.
Critical that Minnesota gets something out of their offense. Down 2 touchdowns. Penix, horse collared and taken down at the line of scrimmage.
Well, Michigan is physical. I mean, they're physical at the line of scrimmage. I mean, Minnesota has had some success running the ball, but not sustained success. And the key to this Minnesota running game is to be able to control the line of scrimmage. And about every other play, Ron English's defense gets the control of the line of scrimmage. They're getting penetration. They're stretching plays out. It's a very, very good front seven that Michigan has.
Cooper, a long throw to the sideline and dropped by Wheelwright. Beautiful throw by Cupato. If you joined us late, we're at the Dome in Minneapolis. Number 6, Michigan taking on Minnesota. Michigan in the battle for the little brown jug that they want back. Took the opening kickoff and drove for a touchdown. Looked like they had a chance to blow Minnesota right out of this building, but the Gophers have hung on, and they're down 21-7. Had a big touchdown called back on a holding penalty that would have cut it to 1 score. Pressure coming. Cupido had it tipped, and it's incomplete. And it looked like Sean Crable, the strong side linebacker, was the guy who got a hand on it.
Well, Sean Crable is 6'6", and he's going to come unblocked. Burgess came on the blitz. He got to the quarterback. Crable got his hand on the football. 3rd and 10 is not a good down and distance situation for Minnesota.
Now they've got a punt to Breston, and they can't kick it out of the end zone. And Breston with a chance to return this from his own 42. Look at the way he picks through tacklers, and now he's swarmed under after a 5-yard return and a line drive punt of 37 yards. Keith Massey was the first guy to get downfield for the Gophers. Timeout on the field, 3:46 to go, third quarter.
Reese Davis with you, the Primetime Pulse. The other games on the family of networks on ABC, Ohio State and Iowa. Buckeyes just picked up a first down near midfield. They're up 21-10. On ESPN2, Georgia and Ole Miss. Defensive struggle, scoreless in the second quarter.
All right, Reese, thanks very much. It's 21-7 here. And Mike Hart has now gone over 100 yards, and when he does that, this team has been 12-1 in his career. The only loss, guess what? Last year against Minnesota. Gained 100 yards, and they lost it anyway. Breston on that little two-man flanker screen that they like so much. Had Arrington out in front of him as a blocker, and Dominic Jones made the tackle.
This team has a lot of weapons. I mean, you know, they've got Mike Hart running it, who's dependable. They got Chad Henne, who's a 3-year starter who is playing with great confidence, field general. They've got dangerous weapons on the outside in Manningham and Breston, and now Arrington coming into his own. Very difficult team to defend right now.
Good fake by Henne. Steps up from the pressure, hit, throws it away. Now, he got it past the line of scrimmage, and he was out of the pocket.
Right.
Good decision by Henne. Doesn't have to have a receiver out there. Just has to get the ball past the line of scrimmage. You quarterbacks know all the rules.
Well, that's a good rule. I mean, that's a relatively new rule that you can throw it away like that. As long as you are outside the tackle box.
That was second one, almost a free play. And now Hart will get the first down and breaks it to the outside. Jones chasing him. Hart finally dragged down at the 32-yard line.
Well, did you see how he switched the ball back to his outside arm, too? There's so many young backs that don't do that anymore. You always want to keep the football in your outside arm away from the defenders. Watch Mike Hart as he cuts this back on the zone play. The ball's in his left arm. Now as he breaks up in the open field, he's going to switch it instinctively to his right arm to keep it away from the defense. Stiff arms with the left, protects the ball with his right. Heads up running by Mike Hart.
And he has 122 yards on the night. It's a huge series for the Minnesota defense. Hart hit, got away, comes back, and dives into the dirt portion of the field for a gain of one. Should have lost three or four, and Tremaine Banks came up from the corner to get him. Hart came into this game number one in the Big Ten, number nine in the country in rushing, and has gone over a season's average at 123 yards tonight.
The only game that he did not run for over 100 yards was last week, only 91 yards against Wisconsin. The Badgers really geared up to stopping the run.
Grady comes in to give him a breather. Henne all day to throw. And now throws it incomplete. That's going to be a holding call in the backfield. And it looked like Reuben Riley, the right tackle, had a big handful of red jersey. And he did. Now, Reese Davis. Reese?
Mike, USC at Washington State getting challenged, but maybe the Trojans have found a little breathing room. John David Booty to Steve Smith. His second touchdown catch in the absence of Dwayne Jarrett, who has an injured shoulder. 28-15 in the fourth.
All right, thanks, Reese. Booty's pretty good, isn't he?
He is good. He's got a lot of poise. Been in the program 4 years. First time he's been the starter. But he's not playing like a first-time starter.
No, he isn't.
And he's playing without his go-to guy, Dwayne Jarrett, right now.
Second and 19 after the holding penalty. Hart goes underneath to Preston, and Preston is covered immediately by Harris, who's been burned a couple of times tonight. Take a look at our ESPNU All-State standings review this week. And it's Ohio State in a battle with Iowa, number one. Auburn, in a brilliant game Thursday night, beat South Carolina. Never saw anything like it when they had the ball an entire quarter. USC playing at Washington State in a close one. West Virginia was idle. Florida beat Alabama in a big, big ball game for the Gators. Michigan playing right here. Texas, Louisville had a bye. LSU with a win. Georgia playing at Mississippi.
LSU will play Florida next week in Gainesville. Big game in the SEC.
Henning with plenty of time. Manningham! He's hit him in stride every time, hasn't he?
Well, and that's two times now we have seen Jamal Harris, number 15, go underneath the throw and try to make a deflection and come up short. One was a touchdown to Manningham, and here's another one. Watch, he's the underneath cover right there, number 15. Now he sees the ball, and he jumps, but the ball still goes over his hand. Rather than making more ground to catch up to the receiver, he tries to jump. The ball is left right over his hands and right into the waiting arms of Manningham. Beautiful throw by Henny, but a misplayed ball for the second time tonight by Jamal Harris.
Five catches, 131 yards for Manningham. Swarmed under at the three. Manningham against Notre Dame. He's already been the National Player of the Week once. Four catches, 137 yards, and three touchdowns in that rout of the Irish, and he is turning in a similar performance tonight.
Last week, seven for 139, three touchdowns, back-to-back Big Ten Player of the Week. Not bad.
No, not bad. And he might get a third one. It's going to be the end of the third quarter. Michigan by 14 and driving.
Wireless. It's the network.
Vegas, baby!
ESPN's College Football Primetime is broadcast in high definition and presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. Ready to start the fourth quarter. You have to hand it to the Michigan offensive line.
Yeah.
And that zone blocking scheme, they come off the ball together. Sometimes it looks just like one of those big road graders moving everything in their wake.
It's not complex. I mean, they don't do a lot of tricky things offensively. But they've become very proficient at it. They take good steps. They come off the ball in unison. And Mike Hart has excellent vision and balance to run behind him.
Henny. Out of bounds. Intended for Arrington. Good coverage by Harris. And they look like they were hand fighting all the way.
Well, Jamal Harris has had some problems tonight in man-to-man coverage, this time in good position, and he knows that he's got the sideline as an extra defender. So if he keeps working the wide receiver to the sideline, even if Arrington comes down with the football, he'll be out of bounds. Harris knew where the sideline was. Good job with his hands and his body. And that's the way you play defense in the end zone.
Arrington at 6'3", pretty good target for the fade. Yep. Now it's third and goal. He didn't think he went down, tried to get him back up and run again, but not this time. And it was Steve Davis, number 92, who played a lot as a true freshman a year ago and is their best defensive lineman.
Well, Steve Davis is not a very big guy, number 92. He's going to do a good job of fighting off the block from the tight end. Nice job, Mike Massey, trying to block him.
So they will settle for a 22-yard field goal try. Garrett Rivas had one blocked this year.
Whoa! Thank you very much.
Looked like a snap hook into the woods.
Boy, what a turn of events. I mean, this looked like was going to be an easy touchdown for Michigan after the pass to Manningham. A couple of big stops by the Minnesota defense. And now a duck hook left by Revis.
So Minnesota still within two scores. And he pulled that one from the get-go. Penix hit at the line, then pushed back. Minnesota starting to dominate up front. Let's go to Reese.
Mike, Ohio State showing why it is number one. The kids would call a move like this sick. Troy Smith to Anthony Gonzalez. Try it one way. Whoop. And watch Gonzalez turn on the Jets. Weaving back, using that speed to score. The Buckeyes on top and in control, 28-10 over Iowa.
That was some run after the catch. That ball was released by Cupido about 3 seconds before the receiver made his cut, and there's a flag down on the play. Did they rough Cupido? No, it's a hold.
Michigan is, I mean, they are really starting to assert themselves on the line of scrimmage. In the run game, the defensive linemen are kind of holding their ground, and the linebackers are flying through to make plays.
This will back them up to the 10.
So the only way for Minnesota to be effective in their offense is to be very good on first down. In the last several first down plays, Minnesota has not been able to do much against this Michigan defense. First half, they had 148 yards of offense. This half, only 29.
And they are lined up to come after Cupido. Penix. He's a very patient runner. He finds the little seams, picks up an extra yard here and there. Michigan came in with that heralded run defense, 18 and a half yards a ball game, less than a yard a carry, number one in the NCAA. Minnesota second in the Big Ten, and they've got 91 so far. It's a far cry from their average, but a far cry from Michigan's defensive average. And taken out of bounds this time is Logan Payne, who has had a big ball game. And Engelman will get credit for the tackle, but it's going to be fourth. They'll have to kick it away.
The thing you got to keep in mind, too, even though Michigan has given up 91 yards rushing, this Minnesota team ran for 264 against them last year. In 2003, they ran for 424. So, I mean, this is a dramatically improved run defense of the Michigan Wolverines.
Low returnable kick. Breston takes it. But excellent coverage by Minnesota. They have won that battle tonight, the battle of special teams. The little brown jug has been around since 1903. Last year it was treated like never before, and we'll tell you about that when we come back. A lot of Michigan fans made the trip and expressing their sentiments with this sign from the little brown jug. It was originally left by the Michigan coaching staff at a game at Minnesota. Michigan asked for it back. Minnesota told them they had to win it back. It's the 88th battle for that trophy, and it's the oldest trophy game in college football. It is not a little brown jug. It's a big brown jug, and you fill that puppy with water, and you need a big kid to carry it.
Yeah, big, heavy brown jug.
Yes. And the way the players yanking around after a game, I don't know how it survived this long. Hart. Nice cutback. Let's go to Holly Rowe. Holly?
Well, guys, after the win last year, Minnesota had the jug with them at the airport. Glenn Mason was giving a speech to the band and the fans that met them at the airport, and when everybody left, it was just him and the jug. So he took it to the car. He actually put it in the front seat and put the seatbelt around it. He called his wife and said, hey, let's meet for dinner. So when they got to the restaurant, he didn't know what to do with the jug. The valet said, you know, you better take it in. What if it gets stolen? So Mason took the jug into the restaurant. The place went nuts. May have been one of the funniest places the jug has been.
Holly, when he told us that story, it was about a five-minute version of what you just presented, and it was hilarious. I mean, Glenn Mason is a great storyteller. He was very entertaining the other day. Good guy.
I thought one of the funniest things was when they had, before they won last year, and they asked him, you know, what he thought about the little brown jug. He says, I don't know. I've never seen it. You know, they went 16 games in a row that Michigan won before last year.
Man, he's only been here 10.
I don't even know what it looks like.
But he has done a heck of a job in that span, taking him to 6 bowl games out of his 9 completed seasons. Grady is in a tailback. Chance to carry the ball a little bit, and they're really wearing down this defense. Let's go to Reese Davis. Reese?
Mike and Primetime Pulse, keeping up with the games on the other members of the family of networks. Ohio State in control against Iowa on ABC late in the third, and Georgia's quarterback play struggling again. Ole Miss has turned a blocked punt into a field goal. They're up 3-0 on ESPN2.
About that
special teams breakdowns for Georgia. It sounded like they had a blocked punt called back because of a penalty. That would have been the second one in the ballgame now.
Miner with a chance to run the ball at tailback. And this will bring up third down.
Well, I know that earlier in the game, Logan Payne was encouraging his teammates that Michigan's not that good. But I think Michigan is that good.
Yeah.
I really do. I'm very impressed with what they look like.
I think that was an emotional evaluation.
Yeah, absolutely, and trying to encourage his teammates. But this Michigan team is as good as advertised. Offensive line, solid. Quarterback play, solid. Weapons on the outside. Mike Hart, as good as you'll find at the tailback. And defense, led by 7 seniors. Fast, physical. Very impressive.
Grady is in there on 3rd and 3, but Henny wants to throw for it. And off the hands of Manningham. You know, he's had a little trouble when he's been in traffic. But it's hard to keep him in that situation.
Yeah. Well, no more single coverage for Mario Manningham. I mean, he's got corners underneath, safeties coming over the top. That ball a little bit high and hard by Henny. In a rare punt situation for Michigan.
Mesko is on to punt Jones. High floating kick. Jones throws a block trying to get a chance for that ball to kick into the end zone, but it won't. Dies the 7-33-yard punt. Turner Booth, the snapper, made the down.
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Chevrolet, America's brand. Chevy, an American revolution. And the ESPN Total Access Visa Card. You spend, you score.
This is Minnesota's Hall of Tradition on campus at the Gibson-Nagurski Football Complex. Among the displays, 5 Pro Football Hall of Famers, including Bronco Nagurski, Bud Grant, and Bobby Bell. And Bobby Bell was from that group of middle linebackers when middle linebackers dominated football. And he was a great, great player. He and Nitschke and Butkus and Huff. And this pass is incomplete, intended for Wheelwright. And we have a red zone alert on Ohio State and Iowa. I think all of us thought this game was going to be a little closer than it was. It's 28-10 right now, and Ohio State driving to put it away. That game is on ABC. .9:37 to go in this game. And Michigan has dominated, even though they are only up by 14 points. Cupido short set and goes to Spaeth. Spaeth hasn't had a lot of action tonight. That's only his second catch.
That was a nice read by Cupido, though, because Michigan came with a corner blitz. Leon Hall was coming from Cupido's left, and he reads the blitz and gets rid of the ball quickly to his tight end, Spaeth. Spaeth is a big physical guy. He's a converted defensive end. Played behind Ben Utecht and has taken his place. Can catch the ball and moves very well, but a devastating blocker in this run game.
Only needs five more catches to pass Utecht in his record. And this pass behind Eric Decker. Check in with Reese, SportsCenter 30 and 30.
All right, Mike, the baseball playoff picture is clearing up in the National League. The Padres and the Dodgers are in the playoffs. Padres' magic number is one to go in as division champs. Cardinals' magic number is one in the National League Central. And the Titans pick Vince Young as their starting quarterback against the Cowboys on Sunday. Gets his first career start trying to spark Tennessee. SportsCenter after the game, ESPN News all the time.
Okay, Reese, we have a second and 10 here. Minnesota really the desperation stage where they have to be able to move the ball somehow. Cupido with time, flushed by the pressure, and throws it into the ground.
And then he's thrown into the ground by the 335-pound branch. And that, man, that's rough. I mean, that, you know, Cupido has nowhere to go, so he's throwing it away. And then Branch lands on top of him on this turf, and that hurts. I'll guarantee you that hurts.
That should be a penalty. That's too late. They do not protect quarterbacks in college the way they do in the pros, but that's too late.
This Michigan defense has really played well in the second half.
Of Decker.
Now that's the second time in this series where a ball has been thrown to Decker, and for whatever reason, Cupido has thrown it before Decker's getting his head around to find it. I mean, he gets his eyes around late. He still almost makes the catch, but a little bit late getting his head and eyes around to know that the ball's coming to him. It happened on the sideline a little earlier on a comeback pattern.
Preston says get away with it on the short kick, and it takes a Michigan bounce, goes straight back toward the Minnesota goal line. The kick only 21 yards. 9:37 to go in the ball game, or check it, 8:48. And it's Michigan with a 2-touchdown lead. Henny has made the big plays. Yep. He made great throws on deep balls. He's been very accurate. Minnesota has been unable to put a lot of pressure on. And the running game has been exactly what you would expect from Mike Hart. Been consistently good. Henny on the play fake. Throws to his tight end, Massey.
Very businesslike for Michigan. They came in late. They got into Minneapolis late on Friday night for this night game. About 8:30, I think they arrived at their hotel. I don't think Lloyd Carr particularly likes playing night games, but took the approach of do a little extra work at home, come in late, treat it like a business trip. Let's come in and take care of business, and they've done that here pretty well.
Yes, they have. Hart again. Got maybe a yard as Steve Davis made the tackle. Let's go to Reese.
Mike, number three, USC in danger of losing against Washington State. This the last gasp effort. Alex Brink putting it for the end zone, and the freshman Taylor Mays saves the Trojans. They've won 25 in a row in the Pac-10 now, 28-22 the final.
I'm sure that's much closer than the Southern California fans had expected. third and seven. Penny with time. Hart. Great cut to get away from the defender. There is a flag down back of the 45-yard line. This could be a hold.
Incidental face mask. Number 91 on the defense. Will have to distance the goal. First down.
Well, Mike Hart is right here. He's going to go out of the backfield in motion, and when he gets out there, he's going to be picked up by a linebacker, Mario Rees. Well, Mario Rees not used to playing too much out in space on a guy like Mike Hart. He gives him kind of a soft cushion, and a nice job by Mike Hart coming underneath for the football and then going back outside for extra yardage. There's the incidental face mask at the end of that play, Van de Stig.
I thought Van de Stig was being held on his pursuit of the quarterback, but apparently not. And now it'll be first and goal. Grady, no place to go on the left side. He cuts back, gets near the one. And Michigan in the process of finishing this one off.
Yeah. Well, they're wearing down the Minnesota defense. Defensively, they have really clamped down on the Minnesota offense. Ever since Minnesota scored a touchdown, every possession since then, five in a row, have ended in a punt. So no offense for the Gophers here in the second half. And now the size and strength of this Michigan offensive line really taking its toll.
Grady. Spun to the goal line, touchdown. So the sophomore gets his third rushing touchdown of the year.
Well, take a look at this surge coming off. Trying to keep leverage, get to the second level, and just good spinning by Grady. You know, instinctively, when he got that first contact, to spin back to the inside. A little bit of a fatigue factor with the Minnesota defense, not wrapping up on the tackles, and Grady gets in the end zone.
You can understand that this defense has gotten tired. They have been on the field a long, long time against a very big and very talented team of Michigan Wolverines. Monday Night Football, and Brett Favre and the Packers will try to even their record. And there is Grady, who got the touchdown on a one-yard run, his third on the ground of the season. Hart had a 31-yard catch. That was the big play in that drive. And here comes Jones on the return. Cut down as he got to the 16-yard line. And with 5:17 to go in the ball game, Minnesota will start from there. Now here's today's Good Hands flashback presented by Allstate. We'll take you back to 1990. Minnesota against number 16, Michigan. Desmond Howard with a spectacular catch. Michigan would go on to win it 35-18. And Desmond Howard won the Heisman Trophy the following year. He made as many electric catches in college as anybody who's ever played.
Sure did.
Cupido throws, and it's incomplete, intended for Spaeth, and he was covered very well by Prescott Burgess.
Well, you just feel this Michigan defense now. I mean, really, the entire second half, they have asserted themselves. They have shut down the Minnesota running game. They do not feel threatened deep at all by the wide receivers of Minnesota, so they don't feel, you know, that anybody's going to run by them. And they have just really flex their muscles here in the second half, proving why they were and are one of the best defenses in all of college football.
Cupido gets that one out, and it's complete. Chambers makes his first grab. It's only his sixth of the year. Good throw that time by Cupido.
Well, so far today, the Michigan defense, we talked about Ron English, the new coordinator, his mantra from day one has been run to the football. Get blue hats to the football. And we've seen that tonight. Speed and athleticism, it really starts up front. Those two tackles, Alan Branch and Terrence Taylor, are such hard guys to move on the inside, and the linebackers can all run.
Intended for Payne, and it's incomplete. Talking to Ron English on the phone on our conference call the other day, Ron's certainly a man of few words, yeah, isn't he? He's going to tell you exactly what's going on.
Well, I think he was trying to eat his dinner also while he was talking to us, because we caught him at about 6:45 after practice. I think he had a little bit of food, and he was wanted to get in and off the phone. He didn't want to be on the phone too long, which I understand. Probably had a whole night of work ahead of him.
Kubota sitting in the pocket down the middle, and it's Logan. Logan Payne with another catch. You got to like this kid.
Yeah. Well, I do. From Land O'Lakes, Florida High School. Was a good friend and teammate of Drew Weatherford, the quarterback at Florida State. Didn't even play football till his sophomore year, but he has really emerged as an outstanding receiver. And Ron English, who is the safeties coach as well as the defensive coordinator, not liking seeing the wide receiver running right through the middle of his defense.
Kubota straight back again. Pinnix threw him a good block. Contact at the two, yeah, and there's the flag. Yeah. Charles Stewart got a push as the pass was intended for Decker. And that'll cost him for 15.
Decker looking for the call, this time got it. And clearly a push with the right arm of Stewart. And all of a sudden, after we do the little highlight package on the Michigan defense, the Minnesota offense goes right down the field. Prior to this drive, Minnesota was in a lot of danger of having only the second game in the last 44 that they've been held under 300 yards of total offense. They were at 205 before this drive started. Right now at 253 and counting.
Payne breaks a tackle, touchdown!
This guy's good.
Yes,
he's good.
That's his sixth catch, 25 for the year. In fact, he has now gone four straight games with six catches each.
You know, he's not a real speed guy necessarily, but that time Charles Stewart gave him such a big cushion out there that Stewart wasn't able to come up and make the tackle.
Good after the catch. He obviously has outstanding hands. Giannini with a point after. Five-play drive that went 84 yards, Reese Davis.
Mike, Kansas hadn't beaten Nebraska since 1968 until last year. Had won in Lincoln since 68 and trying to do it this year. Down 32-25 to the Huskers. Adam Barman, Brian Murph gets in, and we're four picks away from overtime. And coming up next week for the Huskers, Iowa State, who had to rally and survive against Northern Iowa by one.
Jesus. Nebraska game's a little scary for them at home.
Let's go back to the touchdown. Logan Payne, again, his sixth catch of the night. It's single coverage out here. And watch as the three-step drop happens. I mean, that's too big of a cushion to give a guy. And so when Payne makes the catch, Stewart comes up. He gets stiff arm, can't make the tackle, and Logan Payne takes it to the end zone. He's had a very nice ball game.
Minnesota set up for the onside kick.
Saw an interesting onside kick in the Rutgers South Florida game the other night. Very close to being a recovery.
Giannini gets that bounce loose.
That was hit by Michigan, so it'll belong to Minnesota.
It didn't have to go 10
That's
yards.
Right.
touched by the receiving team. It's a free ball.
I don't know if that was Leon Hall who tried to recover it or Breston.
Dominique Barber was the man who made the recovery. And Minnesota will get the ball back with 4:08.
Now, normally, if you're kicking it, you're waiting for that high bounce. Stevie Breston, number 15, is going to go across the line and then hesitates. I think he got caught in between, should I try to recover it or not? And the ball hit him in the leg, and Minnesota recovered.
Blitz coming. Kubadel on the post, spake the tight end.
Wow. What a throw and catch.
Hello.
Blitz pickup. Excellent by Minnesota's up front. And Spaeth, single coverage on the safety Monday. Here's Spaeth running the post on the safety. Nice route, perfectly timed throw by Cupido. And credit that offensive line in the backs for picking up the blitz.
You think Ron English was upset on the last series?
Oh, my goodness.
Going to be beside himself on this one.
You know what? In 2003, Minnesota had this game in hand. And Michigan came back and scored 31 points in the fourth quarter to win the game, 38-35. They were down 28-7 in the fourth quarter before they mounted their comeback.
I'm not sure why they're explaining this whatever situation they're talking about to Lloyd Carr. We have not been informed what this might be about.
We have an official's timeout on the field. We need to check clock status.
If you weren't with us at the beginning of the ball game, the clock was not working at the very beginning of the ball game. It was being kept on the field. And then we got the clock back at some point during this game. I'm a little surprised that Michigan hasn't been able to get more pressure on Cupido, because when he threw earlier, they did get some pressure on him.
I don't know if there's just been a little bit of a complacency that's come over the Michigan defense or what, but obviously Minnesota has not quit in this ballgame. And Brian Cupido, who started out pretty well and then started to struggle a little bit when Michigan's defense really was asserting themselves here in the last couple possessions, has gotten hot again.
Well, it's a natural thing. You're up 28-7. There's only a few minutes to go in the game. It looks like you got it once, so you let down a little bit.
I think it is a natural thing, even though this is a veteran team. And then that's what Ron English, I'm sure, is telling his guys. Hey, look, you seniors, we got to pick it up here now. We've got to stop this. What's going on? But Minnesota, give them credit, still fighting in this ballgame.
One of the odd things about intensity, if you do lose it, it's extremely difficult to get it back, if not impossible.
Yep, it's real hard to get back.
Still checking on the clock. Well, while we have a chance, let's go to Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, you know, Brian Cupido, the quarterback from Minnesota, said earlier this week, let's go back upstairs, Mike.
The clock was at 4:12. Following the first play, we're at 4:04. The game clock is correct.
About that, Mike, but Brian Cupido said this week that he knows Michigan is more talented. They have all the studs. He said, we are outmanned, but there's one thing that you can count on for Minnesota. We won't quit. You're seeing that here in the fourth quarter, and even if they don't come back and win this game, guys, we've seen them put up a good fighting show.
Holly, you're right, and they said one of the things they do is they get tough guys to come to Minnesota. Penix made two guys miss and picks up seven. That's a tough run.
Yep. Well, the problem for Minnesota is the clock is definitely working against them right now. 3:40 and counting. They need two scores, two touchdowns.
Four-man rush. Cupido unloads, and Spaeth, the tight end, makes the catch. That'll be a first down at the 19-yard line. Four grabs for Spaeth.
They have all three of their timeouts left, but they do need to score two touchdowns. And the clock stops while they move the chains. But Brian Cupido really has to get them up to the line of scrimmage and ready to go. Conserve as much time as possible.
Out of the shotgun. Here comes the blitz. But he's getting rid of that ball before they have a chance to do anything. Ernie Wheelwright made the catch, picks up about nine. I mean, as soon as the ball hits his hands, he's chucking it.
Yeah, I really think that there is a complacency that came over this Michigan defense somewhere along the lines, and they just don't have the same surge that they had. They're not getting to the quarterback. Cupido's doing a nice job of getting it out of his hands. There's big cushion by the cornerbacks.
And it will be first and goal.
That was a big first down. Well, we still got clock problems, though. I can't tell how much time's left. The clock just changed from 9:51 to 3:20.
So, long play.
Yeah.
3:20.
So we're back to 3:20. That is correct. That's what's up on the scoreboard. Cupido again throws the out, but Payne kept going.
Little miscommunication there. The only good thing, it was first down and it stops the clock now. Now they can get in the huddle, get a play called here.
Very fortunate that corner was not peeking in, or he had a chance to go 105 yards. Numbers on Cupido, they're mounting, and the biggest portion is right now. Under center on second and goal. Sets, he throws the fade to the corner of the end zone, and it is out of bounds. Logan Payne went up and could not apparently get the feet down at the sideline. Holy cow, was that close.
Boy, we've seen a couple beautiful throws by Cupido on the fade. Here's the throw. Foot out of bounds.
Out of bounds.
Yep, right foot hit out of bounds before the left foot hit inbounds. Nice catch. Right foot down, out of bounds. Left foot down, inbounds.
And there's no such thing as a force out in college football. You push a guy out of bounds, he's out of bounds. Third and goal, obviously. Four down territory. Cupido over the middle, too high, incomplete.
Nice coverage by David Harris. Looking for Spaeth, the big tight end in the middle of the field. Singled up in coverage by the middle linebacker, the leading tackler, emotional leader of this defense. And all of a sudden, now we're down to fourth down.
And this will obviously be the play of the game so far. You score, you're down one touchdown. You don't, you're down two with 3 minutes left. Cupido under pressure.
There is a flag down in the end zone, though, and this might be a huge break for Minnesota because Cupido really had nowhere to go with the football.
Pass interference offense, number 84. Penalties declined. Ball turns over. First down, Michigan.
Oh, and the Minnesota coaching staff thought they had caught a break, but they will call offensive interference on Logan Payne.
And Logan Payne doesn't look like he's complaining too much either. I don't know. The Minnesota coaching staff wanted pass interference on the third down play on Spaeth.
Well, they had four shots inside the 10.
Here's Logan Payne in the slot right here, and Cupido is forced a little bit wider than he wanted to. They're setting up. He's trying to throw it quick. It's not open quick. Wow, he does have a guy right here, though, but Cupido not able to find him as he was being flushed out of the pocket. That was Chambers, who was open.
And you can see what Logan Payne did. He sort of moved to the right and banged the guy who was going man-on-man against the other receiver, and that is offensive interference. Yep. That's a pick, and that's a good call by the officials. Yep. They're not going to be able to complain about that after they see the film. Let's check in with Reese.
All right, Mike, the primetime pulse. Iowa trying to close in on Ohio State, 31-17 on a Drew Tate touchdown pass. Still a lot of time to go on ABC. On ESPN2, Georgia still unable to muster any kind of offense thus far. Still early in the third quarter, but right now, dogs on a march. They're inside the 10-yard line, down 3-0 to Ole Miss. And, of course, our game 28-14 will get you up to date on everything on College Football Final, powered by Pontiac. That's at midnight Eastern time after SportsCenter.
All right, thanks, Reese. A lot of stuff going on. Minnesota has used the first of its three timeouts. So barring a first down, they'll definitely get the ball back. But they needed that touchdown, so the three timeouts would set them up for a potential tying score. Take a look at what Michigan has left. If they win this game, they're 5-0. Michigan State, which collapsed today, then at Penn State, which is never going to be easy. Then they have to face Iowa. And then a pretty good run with Northwestern, Ball State, and Indiana before they have to play at Ohio State in a game that could decide an awful lot. Like who goes to a national championship game? Trying to stay in bounds.
Nice job.
Doing it. Yes, it was.
Very smart player. One of the things Lloyd Carr said about him. Very, very intelligent player. Forced Minnesota to use another timeout by staying in bounds.
This blocking scheme is something that a lot of people have become familiar with because of the Denver Broncos. And it requires a back, the way they coach it, just to make one cut and go. Don't fool around. Don't be dancing anywhere. Just see where that lane is and go. And it always seems to produce big yardage for no matter who the back is. Next Saturday, ESPN will have two great college football rivalry games. First at 4:30 Eastern, Michigan against Michigan State at the Big House. And at 7:45, SEC East rivals collide when the Tennessee Volunteers head to Georgia for a meeting with the Bulldogs. I think we'll be there. We might enjoy that one. College football presented by Cars.com and college football primetime on ESPN next. What does that say? Thursday? Saturday? Saturday on ESPN. College football lives here. And there's the jug. Jay Nance, the equipment manager, will bring it out. The winning team gets to claim it when the game is over. And right now, Michigan, 217 away from doing just that. Face a 3rd-and-3. Hart off that left side again. He's lived over there. Hart breaks it. Needs one block to go.
Look at Manningham running downfield. Arrington, wide receivers blocking downfield.
And Hart, so smart, stayed in bounds instead of trying for extra yardage, which would have gotten him out of bounds. He picked up 54 on that one to ice it.
Well, Minnesota just trying to get a stop. They do a great job of sealing the outside again. That was the tight end, Massey. And then Mike Hart showing that vision. Open field running, and as you mentioned, staying in bounds. Once he got all 54 of it, get down.
Look at Mitchell and Riley and Beal. And Mitchell comes up gimpy. Riley and Beal were hustling on that play, downfield, trying to throw blocks. Yep.
To make improvements, what do we need to do to change? They were 9th in the Big Ten in rushing last year, 161 yards a game. Very un-Michigan-like.
Yeah.
And that was one of the reasons he said, I think our offensive line, we need to lose some weight. We need to be more athletic. We need to make a commitment to the running game. He brought Mike DeBoard in as the coordinator, said, hey, let's go ahead and put this zone blocking scheme in. And I think you can see the dividends. I mean, Mike Hart is healthy. His line looks like they like this blocking scheme and sets everything else up.
Certainly been a raging success so far. Kevin Grady with a couple. The game for the little brown jug, only a minute and 31 seconds left. And Michigan, in spite of a pretty good performance by the Golden Gophers of Minnesota, has the game in hand now, 28-14. They scored first. Got one big break in this golf ball game when Michigan scored after faking a couple of reverses then throwing a pass for a touchdown, was called back because of a penalty. That would have cut it to a one touchdown score and made it really interesting.
Well, all season, the Michigan defense has played solid. Tonight, the Michigan offense has carried their end of it for sure. Mike Hart carrying the load. Chad Henne, very hot, throwing the football. Three touchdowns in the first half. Mario Manningham, Adrian Arrington. This has just been a display of weapons for the Michigan offense. And it all starts with that offensive line being able to control things up front. There are your impact players for Michigan tonight. Henne, good night, solid night. I don't know that he made any bad throws. Threw three interceptions last week. Nothing even close to an interception tonight. Mike Hart, nearly 200 yards, and of course Manningham.
Only 1:31 to go. Now they just keep it on the ground and work on the clock. And that's Carlos Brown, a freshman, getting only his fifth carry of the season. Wolverine with a broken front paw.
You know, it's just kind of hard to, you know, in football, a lot of times you talk about returning starters, and I think that's really overrated. You know, if a team, you say, well, they have 17 starters coming back. Well, you know, if a team was 7-5 and a lot of those guys that started didn't play that well, that's not always great news.
Exactly.
But every team from year to year changes their chemistry. So even a team that was 11-0 that brings back 17 starters, that doesn't mean the next year they're going to be just the same. This team, a much, much better chemistry than a year ago.
Sports Center coming up with Scott Van Pelt and Neil Everett. Our top 25 upset watch. National League hunt for October. We'll update you on all the standings. And Terrell Owens against Vince Young. Not unless T.O. is going to play defense. But T.O. is supposed to get in that game, and Vince Young will be making his first start. This should be the last play of the game. And now Michigan will lay claim to the little brown jug, the trophy they held for 16 straight games in this series and lost last year in Ann Arbor. And everybody's coming to get it.
Arm in arm. This team has a new attitude, a new personality, a new temperament. Very businesslike tonight. And very impressive.
They remain undefeated at 5-0. Of course, their signature win this year was the mangling of Notre Dame when they won it 47-21. And now they've got the jug back. They earned it. 28-14, the final. The jug will go back to Ann Arbor, Michigan. Our final score, Michigan 28, Minnesota 14. Sports Center is next. Over on ESPN News, the post-game extra. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Todd Blackledge, Holly Rowe, and our entire ESPN crew who had to switch with the field and the change from baseball today, this is Mike Patrick. Good night from Minneapolis.
Coming up on Michigan Replay, the Wolverines go north and win back the jug from Minnesota. We'll have the highlights. We'll also meet a Wolverine linebacker who first set his heart on Michigan back in 1997. And we'll look ahead to the annual backyard brawl as we scout the Michigan State Spartans, next week's opponent. All that and more coming up next. Michigan Replay with Lloyd Carr is brought to you in part by Diet Mountain Dew. How Dew does diet. By Pontiac, official performance machines of Michigan and the NCAA. By Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade, is it in you? By LaSalle Bank, proud to support the University of Michigan football program. LaSalle Bank, making more possible. And by Big Boy Restaurants. Oh boy, Big Boy, celebrating 70 years as your hometown family restaurant.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Michigan Replay. The little brown jug, ladies and gentlemen, is back in Ann Arbor. Thanks to a 28-14 Michigan win over the Gophers at the Metrodome. Congratulations.
Well, thanks, Jim. Remember, Fielding Yost bought that jug.
Now, you're going to tell that story again.
No, but he bought it.
Because you're going to bore everybody to tears with the second time around.
Well, I just want to say.
You know, back in 1903, they didn't have phones. So you had to write him a note, didn't
you? You're wasting time here, Jim. It was a heck of a football game.
You know what? And it was. And 28-14, with some real moments at the end where your heart got a little pumping, but it was physical, too.
Well, it was physical. There were a lot of big plays in this game, and our defense really stood tall in the fourth quarter.
In the first half, offensively, you did pretty much what you wanted to do, running the football, and you made some great long throws over the top.
Well, Jim, we were much improved from a week ago on a third and fourth down conversion. We were not very good a week ago. We started out with a plan to try to run the football and get Minnesota into an eight-man front so we could throw some balls deep. And here on a big third down, third and three, we ran the football for a first down, and I think that gave us a lot of confidence.
And this is where they get up inside with a lot of people and open things up in the secondary.
Well, good play action off there, and we were looking to throw the ball deep, but he was covered. I thought Chad Henney had a great game.
This is your opening possession, and you score with the pass to Arrington. That had to feel good.
Well, Jim, that was a large crowd, very, very significant student attendance, and they were a raucous outfit.
The one thing that you knew they were going to do is run the football on you, and for the most part, you held them in check.
Well, we did a good job. You know, when you look at the combination of the run pass that they gave you, the thing that really helped our defense, we had six tackles for loss there. Lamar tackles Pennick, and we kept them in some third and long situations, which enabled our defense to get off the field.
And again, this is your first possession, and you continue to get the ball to your playmakers.
Well, it's a good throw because it's thrown accurately and quickly and gives Mario time to get up the field. Here on a fourth down in the second quarter, we pick up around left end.
Gambling on fourth down, what's getting into you?
Well, you know, you gain confidence, and here Adrian Arrington, Chad throws a laser for a touchdown and good protection. And we're playing very good offensive football here.
Now, this is where they start to come back on you.
Well, they run around left end there. We didn't contain the sweep. And Minnesota's a good offensive football team. Here they hit another crease. And David Harris was all over the field today. He had nine tackles, and he continues to have an outstanding season. Here we let him behind us, and the play was ruled incomplete, but they reviewed the play and got it right. It was a catch, it was a touchdown, and Minnesota, it's 14-7 here late in the second quarter.
And it keeps their crowd in the game. That's why I thought this drive was critical for you.
Well, this is a third down play, and they're stacked in there to stop the run. Chad makes a good throw, and Steve gets up, and you see our wide receivers continue in this game to do a good job blocking. Here's another throw to Steve Breston.
Chad was real sharp.
Yes, he was. That ball is thrown accurately, and good protection here. And
you just don't get much better than that.
No, you don't. It's a great throw, and Mario has a knack to get open, and when you give Chad any protection, he's awfully efficient.
At 21-7 and a half, you're feeling like offensively we can pretty much move the ball when we want. A little disappointed maybe defensively they got out on you on that one score?
Well, they had one good drive there in the second quarter, and you know, you could just sense that they had gained some confidence. And Adrian, we had some injuries in this game, Jim. We had some guys that missed some time. And so we weren't at full bore there in this game.
All right, in the second half, the Wolverines put it away. When we come back, we'll take a look at the second half highlights. But first, we hear from Mario Manningham, says the Michigan offense is really difficult to stop.
He's going to try to put nine in the box. I mean, it's Mike back there. And then you got me, Steve, and Adrian back, you know what I'm saying, receiver. So pick your poison. So we went to what was there, stayed with it, came out the victory.
Michigan Replay and Al Rose Steel take you inside the locker room.
They're a good team. They got a good offensive line. The zone scheme that they run, it's a good offense. Our offense running, you see what we did. So, you know, a lot of cutting, a lot of overreach. So, they're a good offense.
Terrence is right. Minnesota's got a good offense. And you had to know coming out in the second half that they weren't done, that they'd gained confidence in that first half.
Yeah, there's no question. The way the first half ended, Jim, Minnesota was not going to quit. I mean, you can say what you want. The little brown jug is something important to both teams, and they played like it.
This is their first possession. They had a big score on you, but it gets called back for holding.
Well, they faked the reverse, and the quarterback kept the ball instead of holding it off, handing it off, and they got behind us. One of our safeties, Ryan, was made one false step, and that allowed him to get behind us. But thankfully, there was a hold on the play. We make a big stop there. Now we get the ball. We get great field position here. In the third quarter, an outstanding throw here. Mario catches the ball and gets up the field. And we're knocking on the door, but we stall with a couple penalties.
This is a great punt, but it doesn't turn out for you because even though you get it at the one-inch line, the ball actually crosses the plane, and they call it a touchback.
Well, in the college game, Jim, unlike the NFL, if that ball breaks the plane, it's a touchback. Here, Prescott Burgess gets great pressure on a big third down stop, and Leon Hall is in good position. And we get the ball back again with excellent field position. And here, Mike cuts it all the way back against the grain for a good game.
He does indeed. And then a great throw and catch from Chad Henne and Mario Manningham.
Well, this gives us great field position. Jim, that's as good a catch as I've ever seen Mario make. He caught the ball, the back end of the ball, with his fingertips. How he hung on to it, I don't know. We don't get in. We had first and goal inside the five and miss a field goal. So that was a big opportunity that we squandered.
And you can almost feel and sense some momentum switching.
Yeah, well, when you're on the road, you give the other team. Here is one of the biggest plays of the game. It's a third down play. And we're going to have to, I don't know what we would have done on fourth down, but Mike.
Third and seven, and yeah, that's a big play right
yes,
there.
Yes, it was. And then they get good penetration here, and Kevin Grady makes a good run to get the ball into the end zone.
It's 28-7 at this point. Things are in control. Then things start to get out of control.
Well, they put together an excellent drive. Good coverage here, but Cupido hits his receiver for first down. He comes right back down. Good protection. And they hit the seam down the middle.
Logan Payne, he had a heck of a day.
Logan Payne is a heck of a football player.
And here he is again, proving it.
Well, we let the ball outside the defense. And the worst thing about that drive, other than scoring a touchdown, is that it took no time off the clock. They moved the ball quickly. And then they make a great play there, a great kick, and get the ball on the onside kick.
And then they start to drive. Now it's getting a little bit scary.
Well, this game is in jeopardy. There's no question. They hit the big tight end, Spate, down the seam. Then they come back throwing in front of our defense, but they're moving the football. They got plenty of time, and at this stage, they got all their timeouts left.
This is a huge fourth and goal play. You get some pressure.
Well, we get great pressure. We get contained on Cupido, and Johnny Sears is over to defend, and we get the ball back. And still, they've got all their timeouts, so on third down here, we're going to have to punt if we don't make this first down. And Steve Breston there. Here you see our receivers hustling down. There's Arrington and Breston. But our guys came up with a big play.
And Steve Breston, you were mentioning, got a great block right there at the point of attack. Really springs Michael to get out there and get that first down, which you needed to close that game out.
Well, there's no doubt. That was a big play in the game. I mean, because we don't have to punt, because then you've got a chance of a block punt, an onside kick. I mean, that game, 14 points is not a secure lead, Jim.
Talk about the dynamics of a night game. It's more difficult to play, isn't it?
Well,
I mean, we can complain about it. A lot of teams do it, but it's a little difficult when you're used to playing in the afternoons.
Well, I think the hard part is laying around all day long. You get you try to do some things to utilize the time, and you also give them some time to relax, because that game got over at 11 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. So it was past your bedtime, I know.
Way past my bedtime.
And our players, our locker room, you know, was – for having a great win, it was a little bit subdued because
and the plane
it is late.
Home was very quiet because, I mean, those guys were exhausted.
Well, everybody on that team was sleeping.
Yeah,
except
sure.
Mark Beal was up in the cockpit. He and Lamar and quite a few of our guys. Matter of fact, they left.
Oh, beautiful sight. The northern lights you could see.
The northern
Wasn't
lights.
Wasn't that amazing?
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Nature's amazing. But, hey, folks, the jug's back in Ann Arbor.
Yeah.
That's why the lights were out, the northern lights.
Well, now we get to play for another trophy this week.
That's right. We'll be back. Meet David Harris. But first, we hear from Chad Henne. Says it's a little bit up and down in Minneapolis.
We definitely kept it balanced, and we started off great. Ran the ball and threw the ball all over them. But just got to come out and be consistent, because in the second half, we definitely didn't execute.
There are lots of reasons a young man picks a college to play his football. Sometimes it's the uniform, sometimes it's the coach, sometimes it's the locale. For Wolverine linebacker David Harris, it was a past Michigan superstar.
I was a real big Charles Wilson fan, and I remember like watching every game that year, the 9-7, and the way they played defense, the way they was crushing people, the way they was winning. I thought there was no other school than Michigan, so when I got offered by Coach Carr, I accepted the next day.
Now Harris, a Grand Rapids native, is leading a defense that is getting compared to Woodson's 97 unit. To Harris, the comparison is coming way too soon.
They went 12-0. We still have a way to go, so we still have a little work to do, but we're starting off good, and it's a nice accomplishment to be compared to 97, but we're not there yet.
While they may not be getting there yet, they seem to be getting pretty close. And one of the reasons for their focused dedication on stopping the other team in their tracks is the thought of erasing the memories of last season away.
Whenever you lose five games here, it's not going to be a pretty offseason. A lot of those games last year, defense was on the field in the final second of the game, and we lost control of the game and gave it up for the offense. We took it on our shoulders to make sure that was going to happen again this year. Because last year, the game was on the defensive shoulders, and we couldn't come through when we needed to. So we stepped up this year.
Stepping up to the challenge is a Michigan tradition. And as far as David Harris is concerned, living and learning about that tradition is why you come to Michigan.
The winning tradition. It's the greatest tradition in college football. We're the winningest team out there, and just a great place, great atmosphere, great coaches. Just a great place to get your academics. Can't beat it.
Isaac Anderson, the one wide receiver in motion. Here's the handoff, and Hill comes up the middle.
Whoa.
And he came back out the other side when David Harris put a shoulder into him and knocked him back.
Competition is always going to be there no matter what you're doing. You could be working a 9-to-5 or in the office or whatever. There's always going to be competition. There's always somebody trying to take your spot, and you got to be be prepared to not let that happen. You got to always be on top of your game.
David Harris having a great year. You mentioned it during the highlights. He's just out there. And isn't it interesting that he sees the 1997 team, says, oh, Charles Woodson caught my eye, and that's what first got him interested in Michigan.
Well, he's an in-state kid, you know, and he's done a great job in school. He's going to graduate. But he is having a great year, Jim. He is one of those guys that has really made great strides.
And the Wolverines are glad to have him. When we come back, we will scout those Michigan State Spartans. But first, we hear from Sean Crable, who says there's still a lot of work to do on this Michigan team.
I don't think we played our best football game, but, you know, so we played tough. And they played a good, you know, and they're a good team. So, they, you know, so they hit some plays where they were supposed to hit plays. Can't take no credit from them. But I don't think we're totally satisfied with the way we played.
Michigan Replay and Al Rose Steel take you inside the locker room.
They're a great team. It's always a great game. You know, that the team, the way they played today against Illinois, that's not Michigan State. And that's not Michigan State. They're coming here ready. They have a great team. They have one of the best offenses in the country. You know, they come out and score when they want to. So, you know, our defense has to come out and get prepared. Our offense knows that we have to come out and score points if we want to beat them. So they're going to be a great team.
Michael Hart knows about the Michigan-Michigan State rivalry, and he's right. Even though the Spartans lost 23-20 to Illinois at home, nothing would make their world better than coming into Michigan State and beating Michigan. And they're capable.
Well, Jim, I think, you know, we all know that game, you can throw out all the records, and because it means everything to both schools. And I know it was a disappointing loss. I think, you know, obviously some disappointment after a great effort against Notre Dame and weren't able to come out of there with a win. But we know the talent there, good coaches, and a great program.
They have got, offensively, they're very explosive. Drew Stanton, a lot of people feel he should be in a Heisman thing. There's Kerry Reed, what a great receiver. But they got great backs, too. Well, Javon Ringer, although he was hurt against Illinois, he may not play.
Well, I wouldn't count anybody out of this game, and certainly this guy.
Well, you'll see him.
Yes, sir. He has won 262 pounds. I don't know where all these backs come from, but we faced one a week ago that was 260.
And here's a 6'6 wide receiver, 230.
Well, Matt Trannan's had a great two-sport career, basketball. Cliff Ryan, I think, is one of the fine defensive linemen in the country, Jim, and has had a great career there.
Linebacker David Heron is also one of their top defenders. At the safety position, you got their spark plug in Otis Wiley.
Well, Wiley's having an outstanding year, and it's a team that has a lot of guys coming back, particularly on offense. It's a veteran team.
And that's the thing, I think, it's a difficult read, this team, because of the fact they lost to Notre Dame in heartbreaker, and they don't give their best performance probably against Illinois. So from your perspective, you got to prepare like this is the Michigan State that could beat anyone in the country, don't you?
Well, I think, you know, we know that what they bring to Michigan Stadium on Saturday will be a great effort and a very, very talented team that's capable of beating anybody in the country.
The other thing is, when you go into a game like this off of the Minnesota game, there are some things that you need to work on for you to improve week to week, which I know is what you preach every week.
Well, you know, last week, offensively, we didn't do a good job on third down conversion. And it was an emphasis, and, you know, it bore fruit. And there's always things in every game that you need to improve on. And you know, the great thing is our guys understand that to be the kind of team they want to be, they've got to improve on a weekly basis.
Against an offense like Michigan State's, which is the spread look, and we expect Stanton probably will play. He left the game with some bruised ribs, but you figure he'll play. You've got a quarterback that's mobile again.
Well,
and that's going to put pressure on your defense.
They've used him very, very successfully with the option, with the keeper play, the quarterback draw. They've got a lot of ways in that offense to utilize his athletic ability, and obviously he's an outstanding thrower. So, you know, they're a tough team to defend, I can tell you that.
It's going to be a beauty, Michigan versus Michigan State. By the way, wear your maize at Michigan Stadium. It is a maize out Saturday, so make sure you wear your maize to the game, and it's 4:30 start. And also, if you're interested, on Friday night, prior to the game here in Ann Arbor at Al Bell Field, there's a University of Michigan Alumni Association pep rally, and everybody wants to get involved in that. So if you want to, show up. There'll be speakers, and everybody will be getting all excited for the Michigan State.
You're going to be there, aren't you, Jim?
I'll be there, so will you.
Yep.
And we expect you back here, same time, same place next week, when we give Michigan State our Michigan replay treatment.
Michigan Replay has been brought to you in part by Abso Pure Water, delivering quality bottled water since 1908, by Sirius Satellite Radio, by the University of Michigan Alumni Association, uniting the leaders in best, www.umalumni.com, by State Farm, providing insurance and financial services, and by Pontiac, official performance machines of Michigan and the NCAA.